In their football season, it's about getting a bowl win. 67 beautiful degrees in Fort Worth. Fans on hand for both of them. Continues on ESPN. This is the third annual Fort Worth Bowl here in Fort Worth, Texas. Played at the home of TCU. It's the Kansas Jayhawks, 6-5, and the Houston Cougars also 6-5 on the season. Delighted to have you with us. Happy holidays, everybody. With Ed Cunningham, I'm Gary Thorne. We take a look at Houston, a classic matchup in this game because Houston has an offense that's got some numbers that are nationally recognized this season.
Incredibly inventive offense. Art Briles started inventing this offense back in the mid-80s when he was the head coach at Hamlin High School in Hamlin, Texas. There is no playbook. They do everything by memorization. 14th in the country in total yards. Points down a little bit for this offense from the yardage because they're not so good in the red zone. They'll have to get better at that. The guy who runs this and has run this offense since his freshman year in high school at Stephenville High School, where Art Briles was the head coach before he went to Texas Tech, is Kevin Cobb. He knows this offense inside and out. It's not just a throwing offense. If you think that, you're mistaken. It's actually based on the run. They move him around the pocket. He's the number one all time at the University of Houston in total offense in only his third year. This guy, very good, knows the offense, like I said, so well, and he has a lot to say about the play they run at the line of scrimmage.
And what makes this a classic matchup is that Kansas comes in with one of the nation's best defense. 8 games, they've held the opponents to less than 100 yards rushing.
And very good competition they've been against all year in the Big 12. Of course, they took the lumps against Texas, like everybody did. But this defense, number three in the Big 12, and their rushing defense has been sensational. Third in the country, they're out to set an all-time KU record under 100 yards. And the guy who leads them is the Big 12 Defensive Player of the Year, Nick Reed. The last 3 years, he's been great. See the number seven? He was a quarterback in high school when he got here in 2002. The defense was terrible. They had to move him over to defense. He started at safety, put some weight on, and has gotten better and better every year. He is part of three seniors that start at linebacker that have played for 4 years together. That's going to be key. Kansas will have to be very basic on defense today against a very inventive multi-formation Houston offense.
So we talk about the strength of these two teams offensively, defensively, but you know there's more to that, especially in college football. Dr. Jerry Punch.
Thank you very much, Gary. You know, typically the X factor for any game is the play of the special teams, and tonight give the edge in that category to the Jayhawks of Kansas, who are led by first team All-Big 12 Conference kick and punt returner Charles Gordon. Now, Gordon already holds a career punt return yardage record at Kansas, and it doesn't stop there. He was voted second team All-Conference as a defensive back with 9 career interceptions and honorable mention All-Conference as a wide receiver. That's where he'll spend most of his time tonight. And appropriately, he wears number 3 because he's the one player who can impact all three phases of this game here tonight. Now, when we return, our ESPN Bowl road trip will continue, and we'll visit live with Houston head coach Art Briles. So stay with us.
Mercedes-Benz winter event now and see all the exciting new rides we have to offer. There's sure to be something for every wish list.
Here in Fort Worth, as the teams get ready to take the field, Houston laying it out. No doubt about the color of their uniforms in this one. And this game brought to you in high definition by Phillips. Take a look at the other side, Kansas. In their blue and white uniforms and a really fine crowd on hand that will be cheering for the guys in the white and blue here in Fort Worth. Let's get downstairs. Coach of Houston is with Dr. Jerry Punch.
And Coach, you brought the top-ranked offense from Conference USA tonight to face one of the best defenses in the Big 12. What's the key to this matchup here tonight?
Oh, Dr. Jerry, I don't know, man. It's a great atmosphere. What we got to do is execute on the offensive side of the ball, take care of it, and take what they give us. But it's a great atmosphere, and we've got to play well in every area to have a chance to win this football game. But I love our Cougars. I think we got a good opportunity tonight.
Hey, thanks for your time, Coach. Good luck tonight. Guys, let's get ready to kick it off.
All right, we are ready to go. And Mark Mangino on the other side, fourth season, 18-29. As both of these coaches have rejuvenated programs that were in hard times when they arrived. And that's why this bowl game for both of them is so important. Both of them have said, look, we're not just here to play. We are here to try and win a football game. It matters to our program. T.J. Lawrence on the kick. He boots that one towards that fireside corner. Kansas will take it in the end zone. Brian Murph, and he'll decide to down it right there. So Kansas is going to get the football first, as they will go first and 10. Their quarterback, Swanson, who makes the start, has started the last four games. San Diego, California is his home. He's scheduled to be the starter early in the year, injured at a sit, and that's why they've had the rotation at quarterback.
And Houston knows with Swanson in there, they're going to run the ball a little bit more. Kansas runs the spread attack. They'll be in the shotgun a lot. When Brian Luke comes in, it's more of the 3-5 and 7-step drop offense. And Swanson brings a little different element to this offense for Kansas.
Now, we'll see two running backs. Clark Green, number 30, is in the backfield right now. They've got the two tight ends, both Brian Murph, Marcus Henry are in there. They've got a split to the near side. Going to go to the air first, looking deep over the middle. That'll be caught at midfield. A big hit, but a big catch. And Swanson starts out with a 35-yard reception to Charles Gordon, Mr. Everything.
And Houston starts in a zone coverage, and they ran two vertical routes on the same side. And Swanson does a great job of finding Gordon. Play fake gets the linebackers up right down the seam, and it was Schwartz, the strong safety who's around the line of scrimmage, who bought on that play fake. He's got to get back. If they're going to play zone coverage, your strong safety can't be sucked up in the line of scrimmage that deep.
Gordon's got a bad shoulder, but sure didn't show it there. Quick pass to the far side at midfield, 45, 40, 35, and Houston's on the attack down to the 30-yard line. That is Mark Simmons with his 40th reception of the year. Take a look at the starting lineups. When you talk about the offensive line, Kansas, these are linemen not big. They have to prevent the rush. We're going to see Fine, Simmons, and Gordon, primary receivers, Murph, Jr., who will go deep for them. And you see Swanson has already thrown Clark Green, one of the running backs, but they'll go back and forth in that backfield with John Cornish and Green in and out on almost every play. They are both in there right now, Green and Cornish. Swanson, a first down and 10 for Houston. Second man through. That'll be brought to the line of scrimmage. Maybe a gain of a yard for Clark Green. Defensively, the task obviously already being shown. Free and Lane left to rush. Love with three down as the man who's got the pressure on in the middle. Keep an eye on Cole, number one. The junior is a great charger. He gets into the backfield. He's got to get there to break up the throws of the offense in this game. Schwartz is their leading tackler out of that cornerback position, and Gaston at cornerback is their leading interception artist. All right, a real rush start here for Houston. They get a second down here, a second down and 9 with a gain of 1 on that last carry. They'll go with the 4 receivers, and the defense rises to the attack. At the line of scrimmage, or maybe a loss of a yard, and that is Cody Free, the end who put the hit on.
Cody Free, this offense is so young. There's only one senior. Free, a guy, redshirt freshman. And when you talk to the staff at Houston, Ron Harris, the defensive coordinator, said, this young man's starting to figure it out. He played double-A high school football. He's starting to figure out how big and strong he is. They moved to the 3-4 this year, and he is perfectly built for that one-gap defensive end position.
This is a third down and 11, as Kansas was 34% on third down conversions this year. The opponents did not have that good of luck in offensive conversions against the Houston. That's going to be out of bounds. There was nobody there. The receiver fell down at the 10-yard line. Williams was back there, but they didn't have anyone to cover.
Well, the pocket was breaking down very quickly. early in this game, it looked like Kansas was just going to go up and down the field. And here's the position right here, Mark Mangino going for it on fourth down because he's in that tweener range. A punt, you know, if it goes into the end zone, you're only gaining 11 yards advantage, and it's a very, very long field goal if they come out. So I can understand why they go for it on fourth. Maybe try to draw them off sides and then shorten it up to fourth and six.
So Kansas will go on the fourth down conversion attempt here and a fourth down and 11. They move the ball well in the first two plays, obviously. See what they can do here. Looking over the middle. Gets away. The rush pass. Close to a first down, but is not going to get it. At the 22-yard line, Charles Gordon got it, but Wade Cole put the hit on. And even though they got a 12-yard gain, it was not enough for the first down.
And very quickly, Ron Harris, the defensive coordinator from Houston, said, I like the matchup of my defensive line against this offensive line. Coach Mangino earlier when Dr. Punch talked to him, said, we like our matchup. Both sides think that they have a physical advantage, but the pocket has just, in the last three plays, collapsed very quickly around Swanson. He was looking downfield, had to come back to Gordon. Good tackling by Houston in the open field.
So now Cobb will come out. Be no punt, obviously, as they turn it over. And there's a big break right there because after a spine start by Kansas, they do not come up with any points. They love to run the quick screens, 20, 25-yard line down to the 28. And a nice gain by Marshall. Let's take a look at the starting lineup here. You're going to see a lot in this game of Doty. Up front, they have played together all year. Every start, that line's been together. That will make a big difference. They've gotten better as it's gone along. Marshall is their primary receiver. Avery is the other. At quarterback, Cobb, you've already seen, leads in all departments offensively in school history. And Ryan Gilbert can run the football and catch it. But this is the man that Kansas is going to have to stop if they're going to stop this offense. And you already saw how quickly they'll get rid of the football. Sometimes they will run without any huddle over the massive pile to maybe the 30-yard line. That is Ryan Gilbert, and he has stopped at the line of scrimmage. So the task is at hand. Defensively, keep an eye on Keith. He is a primary guy in the backfield to break up running plays and passes. These are three gate linebackers. Nick Reed was the conference defensive player of the year. And Tlaib has come on, number 28. Aqib Tlaib to be one of their fine young cornerbacks. Only a freshman, but they really like the way he plays.
And he's the guy. He's why Charles Gordon was able to go play more special teams than on offense because of his development.
After that third down and one situation, they're not going to get it. Lost yardage behind the line of scrimmage. That is Charlton Keith, who makes the tackle on Ryan Gilbert.
Keith only goes about 225 pounds. He's going to have to bulk up between now and the combine, but he is so quick. Down inside, he's unblocked, and what really started this was Tim Allen, the defensive tackle, got great penetration, and so when the back went to cut back, Keith just crashing down. Now, watch for Art Briles on the next one to say, all right, you're going to crash down the defensive end. We're going to fake the handoff, come around on some time to reverse and make you stay home.
So Keith in that backfield again, we told you that he'll make a big difference there. Justin Laird will do the punting. He's got time as he hits it at about the 20-yard line. Great kick. Brian Murph is back, fumbles it at the 15-yard line. Murph will get back to the 20, the 25, get some blocking. Got a wall at the 40, up the midfield, the 50. He's got a chance to go all the way. The fumble may have set up the touchdown. Murph to the 10, the 5, touchdown. 85 yards.
Charles Gordon hurt his shoulder against Iowa State. They weren't sure how much they were going to allow him to take some shots on special teams. Murph, a junior college player who has the most ability of all of their wide receivers, his knowledge got better as the year went on, and this has been an Achilles heel for Houston. They are second to last in the NCAA in net punting, and you see why right there. They never got down in their lanes and got around Murph and made him slow down.
That is the first punt return that Murph has had this year because of Gordon's injury. He got a chance, and he scores. Well, for Brian Murph, if you're going to start as a punt returner, what the heck? The last time one was returned for a TD for the Jayhawks was in 2000. Roger Ross did it against Missouri, 64 yards. This one by Brian Murph, 85 yards. The first time he has returned a punt this year.
And you look at guys that dot this roster from junior colleges, remember that Mark Mangino spent 91 to 98 as an assistant at Kansas State. And the great job that Bill Snyder did there, a lot of that was built on junior college players because they had to fill so many holes in a program that was so far down. Exactly what Mark Mangino's doing at Kansas.
Houston will get that one at the 7-yard line, and a big tackle made at about the 18-yard line. Wow, Vincent Marshall, I'm telling you, felt that one.
Well, this thing started right at the beginning. As they punt the ball, every one of these guys needs to get into a lane. About 5 yards apart is what you tell them. But watch what happens in the middle of the field. As the Kansas guys go to block them, there's four guys bunched up in a 5-yard area. And now they have to fight back. And you talk about lanes to the width of the field, but there's also lanes to the depth of the field. See how every one of those red jerseys is just on a different level. And that's where the cutback right there takes it to the house. Those guys not only have to be in their lanes vertically, but they also have to be in them horizontally. And they were just discombobulated right from the start, right after the snap.
Tim Allen, offside, Kansas defense.
Offside. Number 90,
he
defense.
Jumped a little bit. ACC officials, by the way,
still
are working
down
our game here tonight. Allen, obviously, a little excited. And Tim Zaworski out of Charlottesville, Virginia, who is the referee tonight from the ACC, makes the call. So that'll back it up. That will move it ahead, rather, as that one occurred before the ball was snapped.
You know, visiting with Kevin Cobb last night, the one thing I was asking him to critique himself as a quarterback, what he did well and what he needed to improve. And he said, I think I do a good job of managing the game. I don't get too high, too low. UTEP, I threw 5 picks, but I also threw 5 touchdowns.
That one's going to be incomplete at the 25-yard line. He was going for Anthony Vlad Blazer, brother. You see the calls coming in from the sideline.
And that's what I'm talking. He needs to make sure that Blade makes that catch. He's got to keep everybody calm. You know, the special teams are such a big momentum changer. It's just 7 points. And for an offense like this, that's no big deal. So just keep everybody calm around you.
Second down and 5 coming up here. Not good field position to start in. Cobb back at the 15-yard line. Rushed and sacked. And this is what the Kansas defense can do to you. They had 28 sacks during the regular season, and James McClinton will add one to that total.
And this defensive line, for actually the entire defense, they're not going to blitz much. I spent some time this morning visiting with Bill Young, the defensive coordinator, and he said, Ed, I'm a little fearful to blitz because of the different formations and everything like that, but they don't have to. 97 tackles for loss this year. McClinton, a guy with Charlton Keith, that they're just very good at getting up the field.
Third down and 11, 41% completion rate on third downs. Cobb's got a good run. He gets the big rush and just throws it away. Threw it into the bench. And so this Kansas defense, with pressure from none other than Nick Reed, the man in the middle, got to Cobb and forced the play, and nobody was open.
This is good coverage. There's a stunt in the middle, but picked up by the offensive line. The back does a nice job picking up that time. And then Reed, who's just kind of lurking around, does a good job. He don't need to go hit him. Make sure he gets rid of it and doesn't get one downfield, because he doesn't know what's going on behind him. Does a nice job by Reed of coming down, getting his hands up, and just making Cobb throw it away.
So they will be punting, and he'll be standing back at his own 5-yard line. Now, Mark Simmons is the man who's back for Kansas. He comes up and will let that one bounce and takes it. He took it right out of the defender's hand on the coverage. Williams reached out to try and down it, may have even touched it, and he grabbed it. It's a 45-yard punt at a 3-yard return. That's a dangerous way to try and return a football. There, as you see, a flag on the play, and it's over there where the tackle was made. Don't know as I've seen that one made quite in such quite close quarters before. See what the call was.
Well, a heads-up play by Simmons is going to get wiped out by a bonehead play. How many times do you see a legal block in the back on punts?
During the return,
it's unbelievable.
Block in the back, number 23 in the receiving team.
If you see the guy's name,
10-yard penalty,
not his school name,
from the end of the run,
but his given name, don't touch him. I don't think it's that difficult.
So the return, a little of it that was, is going to become even less than that. But the big play has been made in this football game already by the special teams. Murph return for Kansas on the punt, 7-0.
rich, bold flavor, Dr. Pepper. One taste, and you get it.
ESPN College Football, the Fort Worth Bowl, is brought to you by K Jewelers. Every kiss begins with K. And BMW, the ultimate driving machine. This is downtown in Fort Worth, where they have a special square for holiday celebrations, and that's the tree that is lit down there tonight. Hope you're having a very nice holiday. We want to remind you at the bottom of each half hour with 30-30 Sports Center. Coming up with Chris Fowler, we'll see who the Red Sox have lost every time on every half hour. There's no team left
in
Boston.
A Red Sox fan.
First down and 10 from the 30-yard line. Handoff straight up the middle, and that's going to be very close to a first down. Clark Green, who can run it hard,
wow,
was there.
Wow, he got a good spot.
The Dr. Jerry Punch is usually on the sideline, but not right now. Doc!
Gary, I am up in the Kansas student section. Now, if you're a University of Kansas student, all you had to have to come to this ball game was a valid KU ID. Now, I'm with the student body president, Nick Sterner. It's his ID. And Lou Perkins said, if the students at Kansas can find their way to Fort Worth and get a hotel room, we will buy your $40 ticket. And folks, 13,500 Kansas fans, and a lot of them are students here in the student section, getting in for free. How about that for KU?
And Doc is not checking IDs, by the way. First down and 10 from the 40-yard line, off the handoff, and Bulling ahead for probably a couple of yards before he's taken all the way back to the 25-yard line. Ooh. Draw some attention from the officials. Marquay Love, who can hit you, did the hitting right there on Green, but it was after he'd accomplished a gain of two.
And Marquay Love is a guy that the coaches have really been after. You know, they made the switch to the 3-4, which was a very wise decision by this coaching staff. You go from four defensive linemen to three. You don't have to recruit as many big guys who can run, which is very difficult when you're trying to build a program. A lot of those guys are going to go to Texas or A&M. And Love, he wasn't happy about it. He had to change kind of his style of play. He was very vocal. Had a little knee injury, but he has really come on in the last three ball games.
Second down and 8, three receivers, two to the near side. Looks like a change. Jason Swanson, the quarterback. Last four games of the regular season started. Starting here, quick out near side, up near midfield. And that's where it will be carried. And again, it's going to be very close to another first down. And again, it's Charles Gordon who is on the reception. 28 receptions during the year for Gordon. He's got a couple in this game already.
It's amazing what this guy has done for this program. When he came into the program, he was a wide receiver. Last year, they had to move him to defense. You know, you'd think a guy like Mark Mangino, his pedigree is on offense. You'd think he'd be hoarding all the good guys, but they're trying to build something, a championship program. So they've been putting guys over on defense. Well, this year, they brought Charles back to offense. Last year, at 7 interceptions, tied for the lead in the country.
This is for the first down, short yardage. Swanson on the carry himself on the quarterback keep, and that's going to be good enough for the first down. Kansas 34% effective on third down conversions during the year, and Swanson gets another one there. Let's take a look at this Kansas team that has made it to their 10th bowl. They are 3-6 in bowl games in their history. Their record in the Big 12, only 3-5, but their first winning season in 10 years. For them, beating Nebraska almost makes a season. They did it for the first time since 68, and they beat Missouri.
Well, the goalposts didn't fare so well this year at the University of Kansas. I think they went through a couple of different sets of them.
They'll do that if they win. Swanson's got it, looking deep. Here's the fake on the fly, and that'll be near the 10-yard line. They're obviously incomplete and also out of bounds. Pretty good coverage as they send the big end down. They will use both the tight ends and flankers as primary receivers on this offense when they get it going. That time, that was out of bounds.
Well, those Kansas fans watching and wondering why Derek Fine is wearing number 84 instead of number 85. He claims his jersey was stolen last night. I'm not sure, so sure I believe. It might have been an early Christmas gift to himself, but his jersey was gone.
Ooh.
My question is, why didn't they steal everybody else's, Derek?
Okay, we may have an answer. You're just stirring up the pot here tonight, aren't you? A second down and 10. Another audible, not enough time with the clock ticking down, so they're going to use the timeout. Swanson, 4-for-6 in the passing department, 67 yards so far in this football game. As he gets the start here, Kansas and Houston looking for the bowl win in Fort Worth. Kansas up.
Thank you.
to play well and win the bowl game. We think it's important for our players. We think it's extremely important for our seniors that have invested 4 or 5 years here. This is their second bowl game in 3 years, and they want to leave winners. They want to leave with a winning record, and they want to leave with a bowl victory this year.
They lost the Tangerine Bowl in 03. They haven't won a bowl game in Kansas since the Aloha Bowl back in 95.
Yeah, and they got waxed against NC State, and they were embarrassed about it. They went down there thinking, oh, great, we're in the Tangerine Bowl. We can have some fun. And it's been a little different trip this time. And if you think about it, both these teams sitting at 6-5. A win keeps you with a winning record. A loss, you go back to 500. That's a big deal in the minds of recruits.
Kansas got a second down at 10 here. They had to use a timeout to get their offense going. A little screen near side. It's going to be incomplete. Flag down, maybe roughing the quarterback. That's what it looked like. Brendan Paola got back there in the backfield for Houston. The flag went down after the quarterback got hit. Jason Swanson, let's see what it is.
I believe it was.
Personal foul, roughing the passer, number 9 in the defense.
L.C. Kirkpatrick.
The previous spot, automatic first down.
And Houston was the most penalized team in Conference USA this year, just over 70 yards, and this is just not smart football. Ball's gone. Well gone, and then to go in and put the hand on him. And that is a good call by this ACC crew. You just cannot do that. Kirkpatrick, a guy who kind of rotates in there, may find himself on the sideline playing like that.
He may be watching a lot this
can't
football
do that.
Game.
You know, they've come out, and Kansas has moved the ball a little bit. Luckily, the only score has been on special teams. Their defense has battened down a little bit in the red zone, but you just can't give them something this early in the game.
Houston had more penalty minutes per game than any other team in Conference USA, and a big one right here. Hand off line of scrimmage on the carry, nowhere to go. And down goes Clark Green. He may have got, no, he didn't get anything on that spot. We'll take it right at the line of scrimmage, first and 10. Fort Worth is the site, the Fort Worth Bowl. They're at Carter Stadium in Fort Worth, Texas. Third year that they have held it. Kansas comes in here with this great rushing defense, third best in the nation, while Houston has a tremendous offense, as they've got 14th in the nation in total yards per game. Ed?
And we can flop that on its head right now, because it's been a very tough start for Houston offensively.
1 yard. Swanson on the quarterback keep. Swanson's got to the 20, and he's down to the 17-yard line. Jason Swanson, Rocky Schwartz put the hit, but not before 17 was gained.
And this is exactly what Coach Harris, the defensive coordinator from Houston, was worried about. They knew they were going to see a little more option quarterback type runs with Swanson rather than Luke. And nobody had the quarterback. When you're playing option defense, you've got to assign people to personnel. It's very difficult to get ready for a team that has the option element. That wasn't a spread option. That was just your old basic two-man option between the quarterback and the running back.
Remember, Swanson's playing in just his sixth game of the year because of an injury. He was supposed to start, then didn't make it. Had another quarterback take his job. He came back and earned it later. Pass is going to be completed. Flag down. It's at the 12-yard line to Charles Gordon again, who's been a major part of this first quarter, but we got to see what the flag is here. Would not have been enough for a first down, but would have been a good gain. And it looks like it's going to be called against Houston. Houston at 70 and a half yards of penalties per game. As we said, leading Conference USA, and they were concerned, Art Briles saying, we just can't have that happen in this game, and it is happening.
Well, and the one against Kirkpatrick was huge. It looked like it was going to be a punting situation for Kansas. They were behind the sticks.
Holding against the defense was against an eligible receiver. Be half the distance of the goal, automatic first down.
That wasn't even on the receiver.
And you know, the hard part is, you know, it was a completed pass, but you would have had second down. Now you've got the automatic first down. First and goal.
Boy, great opportunity here for Kansas as they are in great field position again. Swanson driving this team. We talked with him a couple days ago, and he, even though he hadn't played that many games, he said, look, I'm very confident.
Yeah.
He said, I feel good. It's probably the best I've been health-wise. I think the team believes in me. There you see what they have done in the red zone. They're trying it again here. Swanson, what a pitch to the 5 and down to the 4-yard line. Was that ever quick? As Fontanet came up, put the tackle on. Chris Fowler's got a 30-30 for us. Chris?
Yes, a further confirmation, Gary, of what was reported yesterday involving the tragic death of Tony Dungy's 18-year-old son, James. Medical examiner saying no evidence of foul play, but it does appear, in fact, that it was a suicide. No cause of death released for 4 to 6 weeks. And this is Johnny Damon as he appeared today in Yankee pinstripes for the first time since signing from the Red Sox. SportsCenter after the game, they'll hear from Damon. We're on ESPN News Now.
Into the end zone. That's going to be overthrown by Swanson, who puts his hands on his head. He had a receiver open momentarily, and that was Derek Fine. Making his eighth start, Swanson thought he should have got it to 84.
He's going to want that one back, and that's the exact play that Kansas ran at the in the fourth quarter against Iowa State on their two-point conversion to tie the game and send it to overtime against Iowa State. And Fine was wide open, and Swanson wants that ball back.
Third down and goal, 10th play of this series is coming. An impressive offense shown here in the first quarter by Kansas. They've got three receivers split to the wide side, left, and one to the near side. Swanson out of the gun, looking into the end zone, incomplete. Wanted a flag on it and is not going to get it. They had a diagonal route coming to Mark Simmons, but Rocky Schwartz had him covered.
Schwartz did a great job. And Simmons turned around looking for a flag, and this was a good no-call by this ACC crew because Schwartz had perfect position, and even though there was contact, the defender can be there. You know, offensive guys always think, well, there's a guy there, and if he bumps me, but Schwartz was in absolute perfect position, knew where Simmons was going to run his route, and Swanson had nowhere to go.
Kevin Kane will snap it. Jonathan Lamb will do the holding, and Scott Webb, who is 11 for 11 in field goals under 40 yards this year, has a 21-yarder that's down and up, and it is no good. Bounces off the pole. He's 11 for 12. Sorry, we didn't mean to do that.
You jinxed him.
We did jinx him.
Absolutely.
Scott, we apologize humbly.
Houston thanks you because they just dodged a bullet. They need to come out and get something going on offense.
Kansas still up with the Murph punt return that he did score on to make it 7-0.
Riley, Shaq, Phil, Kobe, plus a finals rematch. Christmas Day doubleheader, noon Eastern on ABC.
Where does reality end and pure vision begin? It all starts with a Pioneer plasma display, offering incredibly high contrast for a nearly 3D picture. Pure vision. Only from Pioneer.
Want to remind you, Christmas Eve, the Nevada Wolfpack team that won a share of the WAC title, led by B.J. Mitchell, a running back, takes on George O'Leary's Central Florida Golden Knights. It's the Sheridan Hawaii Bowl. ESPN's Bowl road trip continues tomorrow night, 8:30 Eastern.
Nella Kaliki Maka is the thing to say. How's the rest of that one go?
That was very good.
George O'Leary, what a nice addition to Conference USA. Conference USA set a record this year with six bowl teams. Tonight's a very important night. Obviously, they want to win them all. They're 1-1 right now, but this is the only bowl game that one of their conference members plays a BCS conference member. So an important game tonight for Conference USA.
Good thought. We'd be saying Houston's trying to find their second yard of offense so far in the first quarter, and they do get it right there. It'll be about an 8-yard gain as Ryan Gilbert on the carry.
Well, they say a look is worth 1,000 words. Watch when he walks away. Didn't have to say much, did he?
That was Webb who missed that field goal.
You know, and both of these coaches have done a really good job. I mean, let's be honest. Kansas was always known as a basketball school. Houston, it was off the map for 15 years. They've done such a good job of getting trust between themselves and their players. And all of these guys have bought into the systems of Coach Bryles and Coach Mangino. So those looks go a long way.
Short yardage. This Kansas defense, boy, they are tough. That is Jackie Battle. He's getting back into action in this game. We'll see Gilbert, Anthony Evans, and Jackie Battle probably out of the running back positions. That was Ashley who put the hit on. And it depends on the spot
as to
whether
it.
Or not it's the first
they
down.
Barely got it by about half a football.
Battle on some tough yards right there, well named in that situation.
And I was watching the referee on the top as he was coming in. He started between the 30 and the 31, about the 30 and a half, and he ended up at about the 30 and 4-inch line by the time he got there. He was weaving towards the middle of the field.
Well, they get a first down at 10 for Houston as they try and get this offense going here with just 3:11 left to go in the first quarter. Now they fake it, the quick pass to the near sideline. I'm telling you, you watch some of the passes and under what conditions they are thrown by Cobb, and you can't believe he throws off the wrong foot, wrong side, and
absolutely,
on the run.
Absolutely, yeah. He's going to run all over the place. But that one, Gary, he needed to take that down and run it. I mean, there was nobody there. He's got to calm himself down. He's a highly intelligent guy. And sometimes that hurts when a guy overthinks himself.
There you see what the Cougars have done. Their second winning season last 3 years, beating Tulsa on the road, the eventual Conference USA champion. Art Briles has got this program going again and some young players who are playing here. Look at the four set near side to go the other way. Weak side, 35-yard line. That'll be brought up to, looks like, another first down. They had four receivers on the near side and instead went the other way to Donnie Avery. And Avery gets it. It'll be an 11-yard gain. That's the kind of stuff you see from Houston. That's why they don't have a playbook. You couldn't write this down if you wanted to.
Well, that's the thing. You know, the one thing that Bill Young, the defense coordinator, said so hard to defend, that was not the play that was called. Cobb looked over there, and he saw soft coverage on Avery. And all he did was he took the snap. It looked like it was going to be a run, and he just fires it over there. It's just a look he gives to Avery, and they throw it because he saw soft coverage. He's got it again up top.
First down and 10 again. Cobb back. He wants to go long on the fly down the middle to the 30-yard line. It'll be incomplete. Had double coverage, but the pass was not going to be close enough. Donnie Avery was running, and Rodney Fowler stayed with him.
Well, this is not a bad choice by Cobb, even though the safety got back and this is there, but he needs to throw this ball more to the inside, and it's crazy to say this, underthrow it even more. If you're going to go to the post and the safety's there, the safety's not going to be able to react as quickly as your receiver. And he did try to underthrow it. He just let him a little too much.
They like to work without a huddle. They do here. The receivers, like the lonely end used to be at Army, they never even go into the huddle. Cobb back again, looking near side. Look at the players running all over the place for both teams. Cobb will throw this one away into the bench. Nobody there. Way outside the box. And no flag down on it, and it'll be incomplete. Sunday night, Brad Johnson and the Minnesota Vikings try and continue their late season surge. They go against the Baltimore Ravens. Coverage begins 7:30 Eastern. NFL Primetime presented by Miller Lite at 7:30. Vikings Ravens. It's available in sparkling high definition on ESPN HD.
Kevin Cobb has got to get himself settled down. Vincent Marshall was on that side and was coming back wide open, and he still threw the ball away. He's just a little out of sorts right now. I think he's trying to think too much. You know, he's such an intelligent guy. A month of preparation, sometimes you've got too much in your head. He's got to go back to just kind of playing playground football and making plays, which he's very good at.
Cobb, 62% completion rate during the season. Big play here. He whips that one over the middle. That'll be caught, and that'll be a first down, and it'll be into Kansas territory. Kendall Briles, a 13-yard gain. Briles, who is also a backup quarterback, comes in and makes a play.
The head coach's son wears the same number that his dad wore when he was a receiver, Bill Yeoman, back in the 70s. He's also the backup quarterback. Didn't know if he was going to play this year. He had some serious surgery on his shoulder, and he knows this offense just as well as Kevin Cobb does.
42 receptions, second leading receiver behind Vincent Marshall. And again, Cobb gives off near side, big turn to the 40-yard line, looking for room. Nice tackle made on Vincent Marshall. And a little bumping going on with Fowler. It'll end up being an 8-yard gain on the hit by Rodney Fowler and Theo Baines. Let's get out to the doctor.
Well, Gary, you mentioned Kendall Briles almost didn't play this year. In fact, he's had three different shoulder operations to put that shoulder back together. The last time it came apart on this very field against TCU in October a year ago. I talked to his mom, the coach's wife, by the way, Jan, before the game, and she begged her son not to play the bowl game. Said, hey, you've made it all year. The shoulder stayed in place. We've pushed our luck. Don't play the bowl game. Looked at her and said, Mom, come on.
Game
of the year,
right.
You got no shot.
Yeah, no question.
And he's involved in the game. A second down and three in Kansas territory. Cobb again, the quick pass. That's covered out of bounds at the 41-yard line. These quick passes are not getting yardage. Theo Baines read it well. And Cobb, even though he completed it, is going to lose a yard on that completion. This is a pretty good defensive structure that Kansas has put up here against a tough offense.
You know, and again, visiting with Bill Young, the defensive coordinator, this morning, he said, Ed, we're going to stay in our base 4-3, stay in a zone coverage. I'm not going to blitz a lot because of so many different things they do. Now, in this area, if there were a place you would blitz, you'd think this would be it at third and four.
41% completion on third down situations. during the year. Houston will spread it out with two to the near side. One slot man, Cobb, over the middle. That'll be completed and enough for the first down. A little slant pattern over the middle. John McGilvray came in from the right side and made the catch, and McGilvray got just enough for a first down. That'll be a gain of nine.
Well, you know, we talk about guys moving position. We already talked about Nick Reed going from quarterback to linebacker. Well, this time last year, McGilvray was an offensive tackle. And Blade Bosler, the other tight end, was a quarterback, and they lost their four-year starter, Steven Cucci. So over comes McGilvray. I was watching the other day, practice, very fluid with very good hands for an offensive lineman.
The pass into the flats, 30-yard line. McGilvray, by the way, in that last catch is only the second one he's had all year. This one completed for a four-yard gain. Vincent Marshall is the leading receiver on this team, averaging 84 yards a game in receptions, which is 30th in the nation. And he caught 69 during the season.
And here comes Houston going to the line of scrimmage very quickly. Art Briles doesn't like the huddle a lot. They'll go up to the line. If they like what they see, they'll run the play. If not, Kevin Cobb will back out. Didn't like what he saw. Probably doesn't like the coverage. And now Art Briles, who doesn't, he doesn't even hold a script, nothing, just calls another play and they'll run that one.
This will be the 12th play of this series for this Houston offense. On a second down and six, Cobb fakes it, wants to carry it, and he's going nowhere. The Kansas linebackers, if you let them get involved in the game, they will be in your backfield. James McClinton, the defensive tackle, came in that. That's going to be the end of the first quarter. A punt return by Brian Murph for a touchdown. The only points on the board.
Different kind of New Year's Eve countdown, 11 p.m. on ESPN2.
This is where it is.
These teams were invited as part of the bowl celebration in Fort Worth to Billy Bob's, and on Tuesday night they got some great brisket and some barbecue sauce and beans to go with it, play a little pool, do a little two-step, and celebrate. No, that's not Santa, kids, don't worry. Keep believing.
Yeah, he's hard at work tonight. He's just got a little while to prepare.
Teams have had a great time here in Fort Worth, as these fans and the people that run this Fort Worth Bowl have been wonderful to them. We've got a third down and seven. Look at this lineup. How about that for a stack? And then they break the two backs out of there, out of the shotgun. Cobb looking. Again, the lone receiver at the 20-yard line. And that's where he's going to be down. But Jerron Harvey was there. They continue to throw against the grain. Baines tackled him after a 10-yard gain.
And here's another little wrinkle you don't see a lot. This is a slant, and then you would expect it to be a go. A lot of times, Theo Baines is thinking, you know, if Harvey's going in and then turns go up, I'm going to do a baseball turn back to the inside and look for the vertical route. But just another little wrinkle by Briles that, okay, you think it's a slant and go? No, it's a slant and out. Very unique route there to pick up the first down.
That's a fifth different receiver to catch a pass here for Houston. They've now got 61 total yards, 101 for Kansas in the first quarter, and that's going to be incomplete at the 20-yard line. The longer stuff's working better. Harold Taylor, again on the sideline.
Well, there's nothing that is wrong with Kevin Cobb's arm. He just, that ball into a tight end, although there's a defender there, you might want to take a little something off of that. The big guys don't like to catch the heaters.
Offside, number 97 defense, 5-yard penalty, repeat first down.
Well, there's a break right there for Houston. They've been picking up all the penalties. This time, Ashley's going to get it on the other side of the football as it goes against Kansas.
Ashley had to come up with 35 tickets tonight. He had to tell some of his friends and family, listen, I think you're going to have to buy some. He's a local guy from Fort Worth.
Both of these teams recruit heavily here. Houston, obviously, with somewhat of an advantage with the Texas kids who want to stay, grow up in state, want to stay here. 25 players from the Texas, however, are on the Kansas roster. That's 2-5. Looking to the sidelines at the 10. That one's going to be dropped. It'll be incomplete. Let's take a look now at our Nikon Game Track, Kansas.
Well, for Kansas, it started out great on offense. They were throwing the ball down the field. Gordon has played sensationally at wide receiver. And defense, Charlton Keith, we all knew, first team all Big 12. Second in the Big 12 in sacks. And then Brian Murph decides to fumble it, but it was just bad coverage by Houston. They got on different levels. And his first career punt return goes for a touchdown. Not too bad.
Not bad at all. 85 yards. Now Houston trying to get it back. Where was that going? That got blocked at the line of scrimmage. It got hit by Kevin Kane. Kane got his arm up. Cobb was trying to go right over center on that pass, and it's incomplete.
And once again, this is a play that they're trying to run the counter play. But Cobb sees that the tight end looks like he's going to be uncovered and goes there. But Kane very wisely comes over. That was one of the plays that Bill Young had drawn up, and they ran. He said, you know, we're lucky we had 3 weeks to prepare for this. They were ready for that, where Cobb comes off of the play that's being called and tries to dump to the tight end.
Third and five, four receivers to the near side. Nobody in the backfield under center. Weak side blocked again. Second in a row. That one gets knocked down at the line of scrimmage, and Cobb is now 7 out of 15 for 52 yards in the game with the last two attempted passes knocked down at the line of scrimmage.
He does a lot of different stuff, but he looks like he is a little out of rhythm right now. Just got to get himself calmed down. He's throwing every ball 100 miles an hour. He's got to start to put some touch, and this is a part of the game that Houston has really struggled with, is the kicking game all year.
That was McClinton who knocked that one down. Field goals have not come easily for Houston. A 31-yarder right here. That one is up, and it is good. Their kickers had missed three of the last four and seven of the last 11, but Ben Bell puts that one through. He is now 8 out of 12 on the year, and the walk-on kicker gets Houston on the board.
And this game, if Houston had to get something going offensively, eat some of the clock up, let their defense rest just a little bit. Ben Bell, the guy who does everything inside of about 35 yards, a true freshman, but it's part of the game that they've been working on all season, and they really need to get points out of that, Gary.
Kansas will get the football back. Mark Mangino's team, a very successful year, Dr. Jerry Punch.
Well, indeed, Gary. And Mark Mangino, the Kansas head coach, is one of the most respected offensive minds in all of college football. And the numbers bear it out. Take a look at his career as he developed early on as an offensive coordinator at Geneva, Pennsylvania College. Gave them their best three-year record there, 24-9 in an NAIA semifinal. On to 8 years at Kansas State under Bill Snyder. 71 wins, six consecutive bowl games. And, of course, with Bobby Stoops at Oklahoma, a national championship, 30 wins in 3 years prior to moving on to become head coach of the Jayhawks at Kansas, one of the best offensive minds in the country, and he's put them into two bowl games in the last 3 years, really rejuvenating the Jayhawk program there in Lawrence, Kansas.
And you know what I really like about what he's done, because he is so known for a guy being on the offensive side. Of course, he was co-coordinator when Oklahoma won the national championship with Mike Leach at Oklahoma, but I love the dedication he has to defense. He realized when he got there here in 2002 that they were just not stopping anybody, and they have put a lot of work into this defense, and it's paid off.
Murph is back there, and we handle by the short man, though, at the 22-yard line to the 30. Cutting and slides down at the 40-yard line. That is Clark Green, who is the short man. A 23-yard return for Green. Lawrence did not want to kick it to Brian Murph, who'd returned that punt for a touchdown, so they went short on the kick, but it gives Kansas great field position at the 41st and 10.
And now the adjustment for Houston, you've got to think that Nick Quartaro, the offensive coordinator, is going to go back to the option. Swanson's had a pretty decent day throwing the ball down the field, but where they've really hurt Houston is in the option, so they just have to clean that up.
Again, from under center, Swanson straight carry, straight ahead, and that'll be good for probably 4 yards on that carry. They'll run up the middle when given an opportunity here, because with the two backs coming in and out in Cornish and Green, Cornish on the carry there, they feel as though they can always have a fresh running back, Trent Allen, on the hit.
And Mark Mangino has always been kind of a one-back guy. And because of Cornish and Green, they started to go to a little more two-back, a little more basic running attack. They do some inside fold blocking with their offensive line, which means the running backs have to have good vision and take a little stutter step to wait for it to develop.
A second down and six. Three receivers to the wide side with Swanson out of the shotgun. He looks that way, had a receiver come back, and over over midfield and into Houston territory and enough for a first down. An 8-yard gain for Mark Simmons, their leading receiver and their all-time leading receiver in Kansas football history. Charles Gordon put the little block on.
Well, the key is Gordon's block. If you're going to run wide receiver screens, your big guys are going to get down to the safeties, but your little guys on the outside have to come in and get blocks, and Gordon is just having a sensational game offensively. Such a bright football mind. Last year when he was playing almost exclusively on defense, he'd get 10 or 12 snaps on offense and wouldn't even have to come to meetings if he knew what he was doing.
Hand off into midfield at the 40-yard line and tiptoes probably for a first down. Again, John Cornish, you saw that he is from British Columbia. You don't get a lot of college football players coming out of there. He was the provincial player of the year. Great speedster. How he got out of the hockey rink and onto the football field, we'll never know. He had a 12-yard gain. Great to have you with us here on ESPN, the Fort Worth Bowl. We're in Fort Worth, Texas, and Murph has returned 185 yards of punt return in the first quarter. Houston, just 62 yards of total offense by a team that generates much more than that on the regular season.
How come it doesn't shock me that you would prefer a guy that good of an athlete to play hockey?
We had to get that in there, you know what I mean? Swanson looking near side, 30-yard line, 25 down to the 20, and knocked out of bounds inside the 15-yard line. Charles Gordon, no sooner talked about than he gets it done again, and that's a 23-yard gain.
Boy, this game has been completely flipped on its head from what we thought we would see. Just goes to prove that nobody knows nothing, do we?
No.
No, I mean, we thought that we were going to see Kansas struggle on offense, and that has not been the case. This month has been very good to Jason Swanson, Charles Gordon. You've got to figure when you've got an athlete like that, you're going to design some plays around him when you have this much time to set it up.
Look at that. Punt returner is how he made it to the Big 12 team, and then he does plays defense when necessary. This one back from the 20-yard line, the pitch up front to the 10, down to the 5. Touchdown! John Cornish! 13-yard TD shovel pass.
What a nice job. Downfield, Dexon Fields, a true freshman who had the first catch of his career, was in the fourth quarter against Iowa State, just fighting downfield, and a nice play. It was so slow developing, everybody from Houston had bailed out by the time the pitch went to Cornish.
And the extra point is up by Scott Webb, and it is good. It was the Houston offense that was supposed to show you all these tricky plays and all kinds of formations. Well, so far in this game, it's Kansas showing it as they went 5 plays, 60 yards in a minute 28, and they lead it 14-3. This game brought to you in high definition by Phillips. Welcome back to Fort Worth, everybody. Kansas is putting on a show. Jayhawk fans, there are lots of them here, have had a lot to cheer about here in this first half.
Well, we didn't expect to see this because Kansas offensively, they played to their strength with his defense, but 102nd in the country in total offense coming into this game and just over a quarter of play. And we've talked about the inventive offense of Houston. Let's not forget, like Dr. Punch was telling us, Mark Mangino's been known for some pretty inventive offenses through his career as well.
That's going to go out of the end zone, so Houston will take over on a first down at the 20-yard line. This Kansas team was supposed to have to worry about their defense, but give the kids some credit at Kansas. Their team members were saying yesterday, look, I know all the talks about our defense, but I'm telling you, and this is from a number of their kids, we've got an offense. We can play offense.
I didn't believe them, though.
I know nobody did.
You know, you're sitting there taking notes, and you're thinking, listen, you're the 102nd best offense in the NCAA, but a lot of that had to do with the quarterback. They just didn't have consistent play. And Swanson has come in. He told us yesterday he felt good. He felt very confident, and the extra month of preparations really helped him.
First and 10, Cobb on the handoff. Fumble, and it's loose. It is loose. There is no whistle. Houston will get it back as Marshall found it. Benson Marshall, but a big hit at the line of scrimmage, and the official had to jump over the football there as it will go all the inside the 10 all the way back to the 8-yard line.
I believe it's Charlton Keith who's going to crash down from his defensive end spot
and just rips the ball out, doesn't. Wow, what a great play by Keith. You know, there's a lot of people around Kansas who say if this guy can put 30 or 40 pounds on, he's going to be a Jason Taylor type player in the NFL, and I can see that. He does have to gain some weight. He's not going to be able to hold up at 225, 230 pounds, but if he can eke himself to 250, 260, this is a Sunday player.
Dobbs now facing a second down and 21. He'll take it out of the shotgun, near side open, and that will be caught at the 17-yard line by Kendall Briles, but a flag is down on the play. You notice one of the graphics we just showed you that Houston so far has had more passing plays than running plays. They have not won a game this year where their passing attempts have been more than their rush attempts. They're 0-4. And right now, the game strategy has been to put the ball in the air first.
And to me, I almost feel like they have to, though, Gary. Every time they try to run between the tackles, it's a disaster.
You see what it's getting them, 8 yards.
Yeah, I mean, there's four guys. There's four white shirts. Every time they go to run inside, they're just getting smushed.
Offsides, number 92 defense, 5-yard penalty, previous spot, repeat second down.
Rodney Allen, that's a break for Houston. He is from here in the Dallas area, Carter High School, one of the many KU players we were talking about who's from this Dallas area, the Metroplex.
You know, the one thing we have not seen a lot, and Houston is not a vertical stretch type passing game. They do a lot of what we've seen, just a little short, 2-3 yards, the outcuts. They have thrown a post, but I think something vertical to the outside. They've got amazing speed with some of these guys. I think they need to try to run by somebody from Kansas.
Dobbs, their 21-year-old quarterback, only a junior, goes over the middle at the 20, 30-yard line, and that will be enough for a first down. Quick slant, Ryan Gilbert. We told you he can run and catch, and he gets 19 on that reception.
Young quarterbacks could learn a lot from Kevin Cobb. When he is on, and it looks like he's starting to settle in, watch how he leads Gilbert with this ball. Gilbert never has to break stride. Gilbert is at full tilt. He puts it right on his back hip, so it's an easy catch, and that's why he picks up the first down. If he doesn't lead him, they don't pick up the first down there.
Gilbert during the regular season at 18 receptions, one for a touchdown. Here's the change in play coming. Three receivers left side, two near side. Nobody in that backfield. That line's got to provide the protection. Four down on the rush, quarterback draw, 35, and up to the 39-yard line. Had some room, Nick Reed, their leading tackler, after a 6-yard gain made the stop.
You know, the one thing you get kind of lulled into thinking with this Houston offense is that Cobb is just kind of a thrower. But this guy is now the number one University of Houston total offense because of plays like that. He can run the ball. He's up close to 600 yards rushing on his career, and that includes the sacks. Remember, in college football, they take your sacks away, so that's a pretty good number.
Second down here and four. They are up to the 39-yard line, their own 39. Houston trying to get on the board with the TD. Again, he's on the carry, and he's going to take it to the 45-yard line this time, a 6-yard gain. Rodney Fowler on the hit.
Already having a great career. He started from day one as a true freshman, came in from Stephenville High School. He already knew the system because Art Briles had been his head coach at Stephenville when he was a freshman. Then Coach Briles went and became the running backs coach at Texas Tech. But he is already number one all time. And when you think about what's gone through the University of Houston with Andre Ware and David Klingel, two first-rounders and a Heisman Trophy in there, those are impressive numbers for a junior.
Art Briles, the only reason he came to Houston, and it has made all the difference on the handoff line of scrimmage, and that play, just take it out. It has not done a thing. On the attempt by Anthony Evans, he gets no gain going up the middle. Tim Allen moved in and put the hit on him. Want to remind you that the Sheridan Hawaii Bowl is coming up on Christmas Eve. It's the Nevada Wolfpack going against Central Florida, the Golden Knights. The Sheridan Hawaii Bowl, part of ESPN's Bowl Road Trip. It's tomorrow night at 8:30 Eastern Time. Yes, for those of you who have not begun shopping, tomorrow night is Christmas Eve. Good luck. And again, a look to the sideline. They're going to have to use a timeout here. Houston not liking what they saw defensively. That'll be the first timeout they've used. Art Briles will bring the gang over. They are down 14-3 at the moment. And Cobb will have a discussion with Briles about what they want to run here.
We've been talking
all night about the Stephenville High School connection. You know, Art Briles got there in 1988, and it's a 4A high school. It's only about 85 miles from here. And he got there, and that program was really nothing when he got there. And it was amazing what he did to this. And what's interesting about this video, this was a 4A state championship. In the late 90s, this team went on an amazing run. And they went to play the state championship. They call them the Can Fans. They bring cans with ball bearings in them to make the noise, kind of like the cowbells at Mississippi State. But Art Briles, when he was coaching this game, had no idea that there was a young man who went with his dad to watch this game down on the sideline. And it was the quarterback that is now playing for him, Kevin Cobb. Kevin Cobb's dad and him went to that game and he said, "Dad, this is where I want to go to high school." And it has continued. Art Briles has brought a lot of the guys that coach with him at Stephenville, and these guys have spent a lot of time at the college level. And when Art Briles was hired, quite frankly, a lot of people said, "Well, wait a minute, this is kind of a career high school guy," but he's such an inventive, smart coach. And I think for a place like the University of Houston where he played, it makes a lot of sense, because in high school, you've got to coach the talent you have. And he had to do that when he first got here, and they went to a bowl game that very first year. So I think brilliant job by Art Briles.
We talked with Bill Callahan about that this year and how it's changed, that these high school coaches are more influential at the college level because the high schools are now playing the same kind of process that we now see in the college levels. And Callahan told us, look, when you go out and are recruiting, you've got to be able to have an offense that the kids in high school are familiar with.
And enjoy it, too. That's a big deal. You know, kids watch Houston, watching tonight on TV, and say, you know, that's a fun offense. I'd like to be a part of that.
Second down and 10, Cobb over the middle. I got it. No, is there a fumble? No, incomplete. Great defensive play right there. Nick Reed got an arm in, and that's one of those timing plays that makes you a great pass defender.
Well, and I think this is why this guy's going to make a really good player at the NFL level, because he doesn't have to leave the field. He walks out, doesn't bite on the out fake. He's right on it in perfect position. He's got really long arms. Remember when he walked in yesterday, and we all see, he looked like a swimmer the way he's built. He's got really long arms. I think this guy's going to be a very good outside linebacker in the NFL.
He is their leading tackler. He's the Big 12 Defensive Player of the Year. You see 106 leading the Big 12 in that department. Big third down play here. A third down at 10. Houston still in their own territory. Cobb, big rush! And he gets away! Cobb avoided the tackle, throws it at the 50-yard line, incomplete. Anthony Ulrich was there to make the catch. Ashley's the man who put the pressure on for Kansas in the backfield.
Well, Ulrich is a guy who has speed to burn. His nickname around the locker room is Quick Six. His first touch of his college career was a 62-yard touchdown at the end of the half against Oregon. But he doesn't have the greatest hands. I don't know that he would have picked up the first down. Nick Reed was right there to make the tackle, but he may have gotten it close enough that Coach Briles would think about going for it. Not now.
Watch this punt. Look at the huddle.
Okay.
Then they break. Justin Laird standing back there.
Kicking an angle.
They do some of the strangest things you've ever seen in getting set to play. That's going to bounce at the 24-yard line. They wanted to run a reverse, couldn't do it. All the way back to the 15. Charles Gordon. They wanted to turn that around, but he couldn't do it. So Kansas will take over as their defense held again. That's the 15 where they'll take it after a 35-yard punt and a minus three on the return.
And I don't even have that insurance.
What insurance, Santa?
The one that pays you cash if you're hurt and can't work.
Huh? Aflac. Ask about it at work.
Can you just sit down the toys?
ESPN College Football, the Fort Worth Bowl, is brought to you by Aflac. Ask about it at work. And new BOD fragrance deodorant body sprays for men.
Well, Kansas has got 50 yards rushing. Houston's got 21 passing yards. 111 for Kansas, 71 for Houston. And the total yardage is in Kansas' side, and so is the score, 14-3. They've had a punt return returned by Murph and the touchdown reception on the shovel pass by Cornish for the two touchdowns. Kansas has the football up to the 22-yard line. They will start this drive on this 14-3 clock ticking here in the second quarter. We're at the home of TCU football, and Jerry Punch has got a special guest.
Thank you very much, Gary. And we at the newly crowned Mountain West Conference champion TCU, and I'm with our head coach, Gary Patterson. And Coach, you've been sitting here watching this game, and what are your impressions?
Well, obviously, love being in bowl games. Kansas has done a great job of staying in front of the Houston formations. They're a highly packed offense, but I knew they're doing a great job of making sure they don't get in the end zone with touchdowns.
We'll come back out of the play.
Jason Swanson's got two receivers, one set back. He'll throw to the sideline. That'll be caught at the 25-yard line, and that's where he's going to get back to, a 3-yard gain.
And Coach, your impressive 10-win season began with an impressive win over Oklahoma in Norman. What was the key to your team's success this year?
Well, I think we just believe last January we could do something like that. We had a lot of players coming back, great strength in offseason, the summertime, and go into that kind of crowd and do the things we need to do was awesome. And our kids just believed they could do it.
Coach, you got a big bowl game coming up. We'll get you to preview that in just a moment.
Third down and two here for Kansas. See if the D can hold up for Houston and get their offense field position. Audible may be called at the line. Swanson's run the football a couple of times. Not here. Wants to pass short yardage. Completed at the 30. 35, 40, and driven out of bounds at the 45. Derek Fine, and a flag is down at the point of contact.
Yeah, they're going to get Charles Gordon for holding downfield. So they're still going to end up with the first down, but they're going to back them up.
It's a 20-yard gain on that. See Schwartz coming over as the captain on defense for Houston to get the call. And they have I'm figuring out where they want to spot the football.
Holding, number 6 offense. 10 yards from spot of foul. It'll be first down.
Ryan Murph doing a really nice job downfield, but he's just got to get to the point where he lets go. Look on the outside of your screen right here. As the defender goes to spin out, he's definitely impeding his progress. A good call. This is a well-officiated game so far by this ACC crew. But
making calls that are affecting the game, which is what you're always looking for if you're a player, coach, or anyone else for that matter.
Getting them right, and that's the key, you know.
They did get the first down, though. First down at 10. Swanson completing it on a short yardage situation. Will now work out of the shotgun with three receivers wide side. Goes up the middle with it to the 40. Opened up a little hole right there for Cornish. Again, Doc.
Well, Coach, New Year's Eve, the EV1.net Houston Bowl, and you will play a fired-up Iowa State team. Coach, what's the key in the matchup we should be watching for in that game at 2:30 on ESPN2?
Well, number one, offense, we've got to control the football. You know, an Iowa State team that's a 10-1 team. Defensively, we've got to control their big wide receivers and stop the run. I think this time of year, the team that stops the run usually has a chance to win the ball game.
Hey, Coach, thanks so much for your time. Good luck in the bowl game.
Well, thank you very much, and Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
That'll be carried up to the 45-yard line. Great squirming effort. Cornish is having a heck of a game, taken down by Schwartz after 12 yards are put up again. He's had 9 touchdowns rushing. You can see why. He averages about 62 yards a game. Cornish is at 41 yards in this one on 5 carries.
What a great job Cornish does of waiting for the blocks. It was the center, David Ochoa, who's just pounding, and then Cornish backs, just comes right behind him. This is a stretch zone play that they're running, and right now this Kansas offensive line that a lot of people think was very physical looks really physical.
On the pitch on the first and 10, can't turn the corner on this one. Houston, great job of covering. They spread that one out. There'll be no gain as he got back to the line of scrimmage, but Phillip Hunt, fine freshman who put the hit on, and Scott Lee joined him.
And they need something positive if you're Houston defensively. A couple of negative yardage plays. Because this type of running game, if they keep it going, will start to wear you out. The month that you have off, although you get your bumps and bruises all healed up,
I always thought when I played, I was lucky enough to play in four bowl games. It took until about the third quarter until I felt like I was really playing football again, because you haven't played a game in so long, you're not really in football shape.
Second and 13 completed and upended at the 40-yard line, but he made the catch, held on. That's Charles Gordon again, and a 7-yard gain before Rocky Schwartz put the hit on. Schwartz active as a defensive back. Sunday night, Brad Johnson, the Minnesota Vikings, try and continue their late season surge. They'll go against the Baltimore Ravens. NFL prime time presented by Miller Lite kicks it off at 7:30. It's the Vikings and the Ravens, ESPN.
Now, if you're Houston, you've got to be careful here, because with Swanson in there, you're going to think throw in this down and distance. But I'd be very concerned about a quarterback draw here, which would be a pretty good call. It looks like Houston's going to bring some people up and try to get in the gaps.
Kansas 2-for-4, third down conversions in this game. They've got another chance here. There's the out route, 30-yard line, first down completed. Beautiful reception to Mark Simmons, their leading receiver, an 11-yard gain, and the timing could not have been better.
And their fastest receiver, and that's why this out cut is so open. He does a very good job on Pope, pushing right to him. And Swanson, it looks like a different guy. Jason Swanson got dinged up a little bit against Iowa State, and they brought Luke in, but you also felt like maybe it was time to bring Luke in, because Swanson just quite frankly didn't play very well against Iowa State in the first half. And right now, he just looks like he's on time.
Yeah, he told us he thought he could get it done, and right now he is getting it done. It's another first down at 10, and these Kansas drives have taken time. I mean, they're controlling all aspects of the game, the rush, the passing, the time on the clock, going near side, wide open at the 10-yard line. It'll be incomplete. Well, their quarterback, again, Jason Swanson. Here's what he said about starting this bowl game.
I have a lot of confidence coming into this game, you know, because I played well, just being thrown into the fire real quick. You know, I played well the last couple of games. I have the confidence of my teammates, which is the most important thing to me. And I have the confidence of coaches. They know that I'm gonna make some mistakes, but I'm gonna stay cool and I'm gonna get things done.
Well, it's obvious by the play calling right now that the coaches do have confidence. That was a corner route. Gordon came out of his break a little sloppy. Otherwise, that could have been a touchdown. The way they're calling this game, they have no problem letting Jason Swanson do everything in the playbook.
He's got to take a timeout. And if we need some Christmas music as we go along here, we can just ask him to play one of the five instruments. He went to a public high school that was an arts school. He didn't want to draw. He didn't want to be in theater. He'd never played musical instruments. By the time he got done, he played five instruments extremely well. Listen to this music.
It's him. This is actually
him. No, it's not him.
Oh, okay.
Ah, jeez.
What do I like about Billy Bob's? Cute guy.
Get him away.
We love Billy Bob.
Kids love Billy Bob.
Video game.
All right.
Bull Riders.
Billy Bob's is country.
Chris Ledoux.
Billy Bob's is Texas.
Well, I love Billy Bob.
We love Billy.
Have you been to Billy Bob's lately?
For the online gift store or our concert schedule, check it out on the web at BillyBob'sTexas.com.
天气预报：今天和星期三将会持续低湿度和晴朗。Houston
needs them one day closer to you.
I love Houston
needs them day to you.
As part of the Fort Worth Bowl, both of these teams visited the Cooks Children's Hospital. Just take a look. Not much needs to be said. You can just see it.
Yeah, I was lucky enough to play in the East-West Shrine Game after my senior year at the University of Washington, and when they take you to that hospital, the Shriners Hospital, it changes your life forever.
And all the players said that, including those who have been at other bowl games for these two teams, said that's a moment they never forget. A second down and 10. Kansas has the football again, looking to the end zone. They've been working on this corner over here. That's the second time in a row now that they've gone to this side, trying to get Gordon, but that again is overthrown.
And good coverage that time. Houston, you know, defensively, they haven't really been out of position. This time he's working one-on-one on Williams. and then comes back to the outside, and Schwartz has to roll over the top as the safety. Schwartz is a young man that they're very excited about in this defense. We saw him earlier get sucked up on that play action because he's a very aggressive run defender, but a good fluid athlete who can play the run and the pass.
3 out of 5, third down conversions. Here's one here for Kansas from the 35. He just gets his arm going forward, I think. No, he didn't. It's a fumble. Houston's got a big chance as it'll be returned to the 45-yard line. The whistle is blown. Paola picked it up, the eighth time that he has come on to get the quarterback. And Phillip Hunt moved in with the hit.
And a good job by the officials not to blow the whistle. Your natural inclination is to blow it, but this is a fumble all the way. Swanson is going to try to throw it, but Hunt gets there before he gets a chance to throw the ball forward. And this is an excellent call. He knocked it out right before Swanson. I mean, it was a split second before Swanson was able to get his hand moving forward. If he was able to do that, it would have been an incomplete pass. But good job by this officiating crew letting that play out.
Big play. Houston now with an opportunity. 4 minutes plus to go here in the first half. Carried to the near side. Cobb is down. And gains maybe a yard on it at about the 40-yard line as Cobb couldn't find anybody open. Great coverage. Kevin Kane moved in with the hit.
You know, we showed the kind of the season recap for Houston and the big win against Tulsa. That game was finished. It was Tulsa was driving, and Kenneth Fontenette knocked the ball out of Garrett Mills' hands to seal the game. And all of the players on Houston say, you know, our offense is always talked about, but all year long, our defense has made plays when they've had to. They helped us win that game against Tulsa. And this, you feel like they needed some kind of momentum shift. And there comes the defense with Hunt making a good play on the ball.
Well, that's the help maybe that this Houston offense needs, because they've not been able to get it going, and everybody moving before the snap. And we'll just have to wait and see which side this will be called again.
Sterling Doty, the center, forgot to snap the ball. It's kind of important to start the play.
Kansas has 218 total yards in this game. Houston has just 84. Those numbers were supposed to be reversed based on how these teams had played during the regular season. Kansas has had the long sustained drives. Cornish, a shovel pass touchdown, and Murph with the return on a punt for a TD. One field goal up on the board for Houston.
There's no foul on the play. Houston called timeout before the snap.
Ah.
The charge timeout, Houston.
Mr. Doty knew something was going on. Knew not to snap it.
Each team has used two timeouts here in the first half, so they've got, each has one left. They got that one called just in time. As everybody was moving. Well, we'll see whether or not the turnover can help Houston out here. Obviously, it's some of their best field position that they've had to start from in this game, and it comes off that fumble turnover. And now if they can get one on the board here, and they got plenty of time here in the first half, they're right back in this football game.
Yeah, and it looked like Kansas was driving again. They started taking some shots down the field. They had it on the plus side, and that was a huge, huge play by Phillip Hunt to get this ball back, because at 21-3, Houston can come back from just about anything. But it was just such the momentum was so clearly in the favor of Kansas. And you see that in bowl games. Sometimes teams, you know, it's been a long preparation. They're starting to think about going home for Christmas. And if that momentum swings a little too far, they could pack it in.
All right, Houston's got the football there in red. Kansas in the white and blue in Kansas territory. Houston with a second down and 8 from the 40-yard line. Three receivers near side. Look to a quick screen. Instead goes into the middle. 30-yard line down to the 29. It is caught for a first down. McGilvray again, an 11-yard gain.
McGilvray's a guy you mentioned coming into the game, only had 2 receptions. But the other day out at practice, I got kind of yelled at by Coach Bryles for taking so many notes. He thought I was a spy out there till I explained who I was. But I kept, everything they were doing looked like they were trying to set up things for McGilvray, the former offensive tackle. And when you watched him run and catch, I thought, wait, this guy was why was he an offensive tackle? If he's this good, he needs to stay at tight end.
Got good hands. Yes. First down and 10 out of the shotgun. Cop near side caught and taken down at the 25-yard line. We're going to get a 30-30 update. Let's go to Chris Fowler.
Gary, thank you. Well, Marvin Harrison is one of 3 Indianapolis Colts who will not even make the trip to Seattle for the game against the Seahawks. They are obviously getting ready and resting Harrison for the playoffs. And Johnny Damon, there's the new look. No beard, no long hair, Yankee pinstripes as he met the press today. We hear from Damon on SportsCenter after the game and also on ESPN News anytime. We'll talk football at halftime, guys.
Chris Yunata hurt a Red Sox fan. Over the middle, caught, 10, 5, and down to the 2-yard line. A quick burst by Ryan Gilbert and a 23-yard gain. They found the seam they've been looking for.
Boy, when Cobb is on, he is really on. Watch this ball. You just can't throw it any better. He threw it, you know, you always talk about when a guy throws a ball before the receiver turns. Well, this is simply a down the middle seam route by the running back, but he made a little move on the linebacker Kane, and before he turned around, the ball's right on it.
It is a first down and a goal as Houston looking to get on the board. Up the middle, no, right at the line of scrimmage. Harold Taylor brought in for short yardage situations, not that time.
And this is where Houston has had trouble closing out the deal. Inside the five, their Memphis game, they had five trips inside the five-yard line, came away with a grand total of 3 points. I don't think running in the middle right now is the call for Houston. They have had no success. Now the little people come back, the big people go off the field, and you're going to see more of the spread attack. Probably something thrown up to the top, although there's three guys covering two.
Gilbert is the lone back. They've got two receivers to each side here. On a second down and goal, Gilbert on the carry, and he goes down to about the, maybe the 1 yard line. Charlton Keith put the hit on. Keith, a first team in the Big 12, and this is where he gets really tough. Now you've got a third down call.
And Cobb is so very good at throwing on the run. You've got the ball on the right hash. I know you've only got 1 yard, but these white jerseys have, they have owned the line of scrimmage so far. And I think there's a chance of a negative yardage play. You've got a big receiver up here for a jump ball. Move your quarterback in that direction. He throws so well on the run.
A 1 yard to the goal line, and yes, he crossed. Touchdown! Cobb took it in on the quarterback keep. Wants to argue about it, but the call was made on the near side official, and it's a touchdown.
Boy, from up here, it didn't look like that ball got over the line, over the goal line. Boy, I don't think that football broke the plane, Garrett. Sure didn't look like it to me.
You see,
his helmet did,
immediate
but
call
it sure didn't look like the football did. And Banks Floodman was arguing that, and hard to tell from that angle. But from the other one, it didn't look like it broke the plane.
They will quick hurry and get the. Now we're going to get the timeout. They did not hurry enough.
I think they're going to review it.
We have the replay.
Play is under review.
Yeah.
We have the replay that we do throughout college football and all but a couple of conferences, and they. Mm-hmm. Wanted to get that ball snapped.
Oh, no. Yeah, our Bryles knows. Get out there and kick it, guys.
But they didn't get it done in time.
But this is the right decision by the guys upstairs. It's also an ACC crew upstairs working the TiVo, looking at the replays. And the key is, it's not the helmet, it's the ball.
That ball did not cross the line.
No, it sure doesn't look like it. My only concern is, remember, it's indisputable. Yep. Video evidence. I'm not sure you could 100% say yes or no on that. And if they can't say 100%, they have to let the play stand as called.
They will get every angle that you're looking at and any others that are available. They look at the same angles you do.
Yep.
And obviously from behind or from that angle, you can't tell. It's only the shot down the goal line that tells you.
And we have a camera that's right on. This is not, you know, sometimes if it's 1 yard up or inside, it's going to be a bad angle. This is the exact angle. Boy, I don't think he made it. Here's the ball right here. Now, he had a little bit more momentum before we froze it right there, but I don't think he did. I think this is going to be third or fourth and goal.
Indisputable evidence is what it has to be of the call that was made on the field stands. That's the rule. And the people upstairs are replaying and replaying. Obviously, it's an enormously important play.
Let's freeze it right when he stops his forward momentum and see if we can pick up where the ball is. You know, here's your goal line. And it looks to me like that's the ball. I mean, it's a couple of inches either way, but right there at the end, though, you know why it's hard? The defender from Kansas, his hand covers up where you'd see the ball.
Unless they're certain, though, they can't overturn it. A Let's check in with Doc. Jerry?
Well, our ACC referee was trying to hear on the wireless mics as they were doing the replays upstairs. And the explanation they were giving him was cutting in and out. So he's gone over to a hardwire headset now behind the Kansas bench. And he's going to listen because apparently it's a fairly extensive explanation they're giving him from upstairs. He was asking a couple of questions back. And they're taking their time as well. They should on these kind of video replays.
Remember, they can't go by a hunch. My hunch is he didn't make it. That's what it looked like. But, you know, Gary, that hand that came in late, it was really tough to tell. The very farthest he went with his momentum, did the ball get across?
We're going to find out right now.
What do you think?
Touchdown.
There's no indisputable evidence to reverse the call in the field. We have a touchdown.
Even though I don't think he scored, I think that's the right way to do it, because there was just a tiny bit of doubt whether he made it or not, so just let it stand.
I like the fact that that rule has been phrased that way, that it gives the officials on the field their call, unless they were clearly wrong.
I agree.
I think that's appropriate.
I think the way college football does it is even better than the NFL system.
So a big touchdown right there. Now Ben Bell will be going for the extra point. And a touchdown for Houston, and the extra point is up, and it is good. And keep in mind, this touchdown, it came off the turnover, and that's what the shaking of the head is on that side. Kansas has the 14-10 lead, but the high-powered Houston offense has started to get it going here in the second quarter. And this football game has been a whole lot more than we expected it would be offensively and actually defensively. I mean, it's just been the convolution of what we thought we were going to see.
And it looks like Art Briles has found something he's going to go back to.
Yep.
Gilbert, the running back. When Reed walks out, the Big 12 Defensive Player of the Year, the outside linebacker, the two guys left in the middle aren't great cover guys. And Coach Young, the defensive coordinator from Kansas, doesn't want to try to do a whole bunch of matching of personnel, but he might have to try to get in a strong safety to cover the running back out of the backfield.
Kansas will get the football back. The kick goes to the far side. And they'll let it bounce out of bounds as it does at the 7-yard line. Want to remind you, coming up on our Fort Worth Bowl halftime report, Chris Fowler, Mark May, Robert Smith, they'll give you the scores, news, and analysis, including a Big 12 breakdown, the respect for West Virginia with a question mark, and O'Leary and redemption. All
you know, I've always wanted to let the country know what Mark May's nickname is.
And that would be?
And he's going to hate me. And I have no idea where it came from. I played with Mark with the Arizona Cardinals, and Joe Bugle was our coach. Footsie.
He's got a bounce against the kicking team. The ball will be put in play at the 35-yard line, first down.
He's got massive feet. I mean, he wears like a 14 or 15 or something ridiculous.
You're not going to have any feet at all after that remark. Footsie. Mark May, we congratulate you on that. That was Ed Cunningham.
Yeah. Oh, he knows exactly who it is.
I know. I just want to make sure. It's a first down and 10 for Kansas. They've got the 14-10 lead. Try and add to it. Swanson looking deep. Oh, he wanted to heave one. He does, but he didn't have anybody open. They were going straight down the middle to Brian Murph if he had been open. Murph just ran a fly pattern down the middle, but he was covered. So he ends up putting it in the seats.
Yeah, Murph doesn't lack for speed, does he?
He was down at the 30-yard line.
Yeah, and he's a guy that they've really wanted to get more involved. A long strider does a good job coming back to the middle. But Schwartz has been doing a nice job. You know, he made that one mistake early when they hit Gordon in the seam when he came down. But Schwartz learned his lesson, and he's backpedaling pretty well.
Swanson again, second down and 10 on the handoff up the middle, and the Houston defense rises to the occasion. Gain of maybe two on that for Clark Green. Green in and out of there with Cornish. Cornish so far has had the big game out of that running back position, but Green can get you some yards. He is a hard-nosed runner, and they love to send him straight ahead up the middle.
Green, a guy who early in his career would just try to run into everybody. He's learned to make people miss a little bit. And now behind the chains, a little momentum for Houston. This is exactly when you're playing defense, third and seven or more is a win for you. It closes the playbook down for Kansas.
Third down conversion rate, 3 out of 6. Handoff straight up the middle, 40. Great second effort, but not enough for a first down, as again, it was Clark Green on the carry, and Lane took him down after a hit of 7 yards, and that's going to do it here at the half. It has been a surprising first half. We're going to hear from the one or both of the coaches here in just a moment. Let's get downstairs. Doc, who you got?
I'm with head coach Mark Mangino. And coach, the short passing game, again, it hurt you late in the first half. How do you adjust at halftime for that?
Well, I think that, you know, we're going to have to heat it up a little bit. We haven't brought a lot of pressure, trying to keep things in front of us. But I think we probably have to bring a little bit more pressure here. It's something that we do very well. And I just think that just to keep them off balance a little bit in the short passing game.
What are your impressions of your offense's play in the first half?
Well, I thought we did some good things, but we came up short on points. You know, we got down here and early in the game and threw a pass, had a chance for first down, came up a yard short, missed 3 points on a kick, and then turned the ball over down here while we're moving the ball. But I feel pretty good about our offense. We just got to punch it in, take it all away.
Okay, coach, thanks for your time. Gary?
One big fumble, of course, committed by Kansas that allowed for that touchdown by Houston. 14-10, Kansas with a lead. We're going to go to our studio now, the Fort Worth Bowl halftime report. Chris, Mark, and Robert.
Gary, thank you. Yeah, I am here with Footsie May over there in the last
16?
Yeah.
He sold you short. Yeah, he said size 14 or something.
Believe it or not, they used to be 17, but the older I got, my foot started to shrink, and now they're size 16.
That's interesting.
If only we had time at halftime for the whole foot shrinking story. We'll get to football in just a second, but first, of course, the story that has both Boston and New York all revved up. Johnny Damon leaving the Red Sox, signing the big contract with the Yankees, and showing up today with a brand new, much shorter haircut. Reportedly, a stylist on the East Side named Chantal performed the honors. Everything is news in New York when you're Johnny Damon. He says, however, he's going to be the same guy despite the new haircut.
I have to be Johnny Damon, the fun-loving, easygoing, short hair guy. And it's going to be a tremendous challenge, and I look forward to playing here for this 4 years, 81 games a year, short right field porch. I'm thrilled. Oh, no garage door in the outfield, padded walls. Those are going to be much better for me.
It'll be a big story in the New York newspapers tomorrow. I promise he gets a haircut. Meanwhile, Peter Gammon's reporting that Craig Gloss expected to be traded to Toronto in exchange for Miguel Batista. We talked earlier about Marvin Harrison not traveling to Seattle, a minor hand injury that should not keep him out for the playoffs, and a rematch 12 years later. Bernard Hopkins, who's 41, Roy Jones Jr., who is 37, will get it on March 11th, 12 years after their first fight. And Allen Iverson, well, it wasn't quite Kobe Bryant-esque, but 53 points tonight as the Sixers go down to the Hawks, 111-108. He always has the big point total in the loss, right? Yeah. It's a common thing in the NBA.
Score 50, but cheap points. Yeah, over 30 points a game.
All right. We'll come back. West Virginia, 10-1. BCS bowl bound, but the Mountaineers want respect. We'll talk about that coming up next.
The NBA on ABC Christmas doubleheader. Noon Eastern on ABC.
And now, the four finalists for the Pontiac Game-Changing Performance of the Year.
Crow throw and hole. Croyle looks that way. Throws it long. Into the grasp of Tyrone Crow throw! Into the end zone, he rolls!
Inside the Texas 20. Back to back jump. Under pressure. Steps out of it. Tucks it in and runs. To the 25. Fitz for the first down to the 30. Up the sideline. Jung to midfield. 45-40. Say goodnight to this one. Vince Young, 80 yards.
Robinson delivers downfield for Derek Williams. Wide open at the 10. Derek cuts inside to the 5. Touchdown, Penn State.
Fans can vote once per week throughout December for the Pontiac Game-Changing Performance of the Year. The winning play will be announced during the Rose Bowl, and that school will receive a $100,000 scholarship contribution from Pontiac. Cast your vote at Pontiac.com/NCAA.
4-point lead over Houston, but the Cougars should have some momentum down there in Fort Worth. A touchdown just before the half. Halftime of the Fort Worth Bowl as our road trip continues here. Happy holidays to you. Final BCS standings, you can see that West Virginia did not make the top 10. Mountaineers ranked behind six teams that have two losses, despite being 10-1. It's because the pollsters don't have a lot of respect for the Big East Conference. In fact, guys, the talk the last couple of years has been this conference does not deserve an automatic bid to get into the BCS. West Virginia is the surprise winner of the league, and they could shut up all that talk if they could upset Georgia in the Sugar Bowl.
And I think they've got a great chance of doing that. I think going into the game, they're in an upbeat situation where Rich Rodriguez has done a fantastic job with Pat White, the quarterback. He only has 7 touchdown passes and 5 interceptions on the season, but he does a wonderful job of operating that offense and running the football with their spread option. And Steve Slayton, the freshman, over 1,000 yards rushing, done a great job running the football. But I think if they go into the Sugar Bowl and defeat Georgia, it's going to be a very physical game. I think it's going to be a fairly low-scoring game because West Virginia will control the clock and they will game receive. Now, you look at the Big East. You've got South Florida, Louisville coming in, Cincinnati coming in. Yes, they lost Virginia Tech, Boston College, and Miami. But I think the next couple of years, you're going to see these teams do much better down the road because right now, West Virginia was in a rebuilding year. They've got one loss. That was to Virginia Tech. At that time, they were number 3 in the country.
What about Pitt?
They're rebuilding.
I don't know if I'd agree that this is a real emerging strong conference in football. I would say that West Virginia going into next season is going to be very highly regarded. Clearly the favorite to win that league, and they could be ranked preseason top 10.
If you look at the Big 12, you've got 2 or 3 teams that are very good teams, and the rest, it's very mediocre. It's just like that in almost every conference. They don't have the great teams in that conference, but West Virginia right now has proven that they deserve the bid.
What about before the season? Everybody had this talk about Louisville running the table. And
that just shows you that the Big East is a much better conference than Conference USA.
Oh, well, hey. Okay. Well,
is it true or not?
We do agree with that.
Yes, okay.
What about the Big 12, though, which has been called Texas and the 11 Dwarfs, disparaged by a lot of people because only Texas and Texas Tech are ranked out of this league in the final AP poll. Oklahoma just missing, probably does deserve to be ranked, but, you know, guys, Oklahoma, Nebraska, Colorado, Texas, all underdogs in their bowl games. So this is a league that's been beaten up a little bit, too.
Yeah, Oklahoma, though. Yeah, I mean, you could really see them turning things around a little bit. Rhett Bomar's played a lot better. Adrian Peterson getting healthy. I just love watching that guy run. And looking to next season, I'll tell you, I'm real excited to see that team next year because they played decent defense this year, but that offense with Peterson and Bomar developing, it should be pretty good.
So you've got Oklahoma beating Oregon, which would be some respect for the Big 12. It's a 10-1 Ducks team out of the Pac-10. Texas Tech and Alabama. I mean, there's a chance for this league. You see Kansas leading here at halftime.
Well, if Texas Tech scores 2 touchdowns, they could very well win that game. Alabama, Brody Croix is a great quarterback, but that offense, a little shaky lately.
And then Nebraska finished the season strong, but they have to play Michigan, though. But
they're going to get ruled by Michigan. Michigan will probably score in the 40s in that game. I think Michigan athletically is much better than Nebraska right now, and they're getting healthy. You've got Michael Hart coming back healthy, Steve Breston. I think they'll roll over Nebraska.
But ultimately, I think a lot of fans will judge the league by what you do in the bigger bowl. So if your Texas team upsets USC in the Rose Bowl, nobody's going to remember how many bowls.
I've been telling you all day that Texas will upset USC.
That's right. That's what you said. I forgot.
That is a dramatic 180 from an hour and a half ago. George O'Leary, speaking of dramatic turnarounds from 17 straight losses to a bowl game tomorrow night. We'll hear from the coach coming up.
Gingerbread Blast. Sonic's got it, others don't. It's your favorite holiday cookie, crumbled into a delicious frozen treat. Sonic's new Gingerbread Blast. Buy reloadable My Sonic card today and give the gift of great food. It's not just good, it's Sonic good.
Well, the Bowl Challenge Cup presented by Cooper Tires. Last year's final standings, the Mountain West took home the championship. But what's noteworthy is really how balanced the one-loss records were for all of these conferences. There was no conference that really had runaway success in the bowls the way the ACC did a couple of years ago.
No, not last year, but this year it could be the Pac-10. Keep an eye on the Pac-10 this year. Cal's win the other night. They rolled. Ran the football very well in that football game, very impressive in that game, and I think USC will squeak by Texas. I guess those Texas fans out there are a little upset by me, and I think Oregon's got a chance to beat Oklahoma, but that would be
what we ought to do in this. We ought to wait the bowls and then squeak. That's the way we ought to do it.
You know what? You're right. You're on to something.
That's a good point.
What simple one-loss record is too simplistic. That's a good idea from Robert, for next year. Meanwhile, George O'Leary tomorrow night will try for the ninth win of the season for UCF, which would equal the greatest one-season turnaround in the history of college football. This was a veteran coach badly in need of redemption and a program in Orlando badly in need of rebuilding. And as Steve Seifers reports, they came together in pretty dramatic fashion this season.
Georgia Tech coach George O'Leary will be announced this afternoon as the new head man in South Bend.
I'm very happy to be at Notre Dame. I came to Notre Dame to win games and win a lot of them.
Imagine you finally land the one job you dreamed of, and then you lose it. Imagine you're a winner, and then you're not. Imagine you're George O'Leary.
I think in the last 4 years, I've been to the penthouse, the outhouse, and back.
The journey began December 2001, when the Irish Catholic O'Leary left Georgia Tech to become Notre Dame's head coach. 5 days later, he resigned because of a resume he'd embellished 25 years before.
How dark were those days?
I was more concerned about my family and how they responded to things and stuff. I'm very thick-skinned, and I knew eventually I was going to do something, but I think the best thing that happened was Mike calling, saying, come on to work.
Mike Tice, at the time the newly named coach of the Minnesota Vikings, hired O'Leary as an assistant. Then, in December of 2003, came a call from UCF athletic director Steve Orsini, who'd worked with O'Leary at Georgia Tech.
I knew when we saw that we needed to change our leadership here, there was only one man on top of my list, and that was George O'Leary.
O'Leary took over the Golden Knights for the 2004 season, doing what he'd always done, with one exception, win. 0-11 last season, 0-2 to start 2005.
What did Coach say to the team when he had just lost his 13th in a row? The program had just lost its 17th in a row.
Says what he says every week. He says, you know, it's all about the players. Always stay together, stay positive.
The kids weren't second-guessing the old white-haired coach. And sure enough, we turned it around.
It started September 24th with an upset of Marshall.
The goalpost comes down. Final score, UCF 23, Marshall 13.
Young and inexperienced at the beginning of the season, the Knights learned with every game and won 7 of the next 8.
Intercepted! It's over, baby!
But when they clinched a Conference USA championship berth at Rice November 19th, came the most surprising discovery of the season.
I think some of us never knew he actually had teeth. He was smiling.
Should you win Saturday, will you smile?
I will smile. I will smile. So you'll see it for the second time.
Now, people have seen the potential at UCF for a long time, but to go from 17 straight losses and that mindset, that total despair, to a bowl game is mind-boggling. It's amazing to me.
Yeah, it really is incredible. It's not like you can go out and pick up the best free agent or something right. Like that in college. You know, you just really have to go in there and change the whole attitude of the team.
Not only that, the culture, but if you look at this team, the numbers aren't very impressive. They're 82 in total defense, 55 right. In total offense. But I think what he's been able to do is get the players to believe in one another and play as a team. I think that was the key. And that was really what they did to turn it around this season and win the 8 games that they've won this season.
Now, their opponent in the Sheridan Hawaii Bowl tomorrow night's a pretty good turnaround story, too. And Nevada, with a high-powered offense, is the favorite that game. O'Leary's team coming off that loss in their home field in the Cougar championship game to Tulsa will have a tough time, I think, for Nevada. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a tough time. That's a lean from the host in that one.
Yeah, that's
8:30.
Crystal coming back
Eastern.
From upstairs back.
3:30 Hawaii.
When I came to the Heinz College of Architecture at the University of Houston, I wanted to build something, an environment where students can explore their imagination. I'm an architect, and the environment is really conducive to creative thought. Reading, painting, by thinking about philosophy, about film, about the city itself, about other cities, about other cultures. Last year, my students swept the awards at an international competition in Milan. We took first place and were the only school to win multiple awards. I'm Dietmar Fröhlich, and I identify a great university with great students like these.
ESPN's NFL football. Robert Smith, your former team, the Vikings, in the playoffs by 8-6 against the rejuvenated Ravens with Kyle Bowler playing well. You like their chances Sunday night?
I like the Vikings in this one.
It's been fun, you guys.
You're off scholarship. You can really say who you are.
You guys have a Merry Christmas. We'll be out there. The second half is coming up. This is Brian Murph, the punt return for the Jayhawks. That's the difference in the game right now. 14-10 over the Cougars. The second half is coming up next.
through a year of saying no to redeeming credit card miles. Enjoy your bonuses.
Hey, hey, maybe next year we can say yes.
No.
Go from no to no hassle with Capital One No Hassle Rewards. There are no blackout dates on any airline, anytime.
I should have worked at Capital One!
What's in your wallet?
And welcome back, everybody. The Christmas season here in Fort Worth. The holidays underway and brightly lit. And so has been the offense in this game for Kansas, which for all of us who are experts in football, is a bit of a surprise. Hello, everybody. With Ed Cunningham, I'm Gary Tharr. We set you up for this game telling you about Houston's high-powered offense, Kansas defense, all the big numbers they put up all season long. And whoops.
Yeah, it flopped around.
What happened?
And we even talked about Charles Gordon being the big punt returner, and of course then Brian Murph takes it back. But it's been a very good game for Jason Swanson offensively. He's been very good in the pocket for Kansas. And when you look at the highlights from the first half, you know, when we started the game, I talked about how great Houston was offensively and how great Kansas was defensively. And Doc talked about how great Charles Gordon was in returning punts. And Brian Murph, a junior college transfer, gets his first shot at it at the Division 1A level and goes 85 yards for the touchdown. Bad coverage there by Houston. But then there was a little doink in the kicking game for Kansas. So even though they moved the ball well at times, only coming away with 14 points, and it looks like to me that Houston has found a little something, and it's Ryan Gilbert out of the backfield. We'll see. That's the adjustment. Go back to that for Houston. You look at the game statistically, and it's flopped on its head. 231 yards in the first half for Kansas, who's the 102nd best offense in NCAA in total yardage. So really unexpected so far.
Kansas has been led by John Corner. She's picked up 38 yards on 6 carries rushing. Not expected in this game. So for Houston, how do you get it going? Head coach Briles, Doc.
Well, at halftime in the Houston locker room, Art Briles talked about they've got to be more physical up front, and they got to come out and run the football in the second half. They're not doing a very good job running the ball up the middle between the tackles. He challenged his offensive line to be a little more physical up front. They're going to try to run it here early in the third quarter.
Here. Houston will get the football at the 4-yard line on the kickoff to start the second half. Turned out to the 15, 20-yard line, and that is Vincent Marshall on a nice return. So the Houston offense will go to work. Marshall will average 17 yards on returns for Coach Art Briles. His team, their 16th bowl appearance. This school is 7-7-1, but they've gone 0-5 in their last 5 bowl games. You take a look at the summary of that first half.
Houston's got a little ways to go to catch up to their average. And, you know, I know Coach Briles told Doc that they want to try to run the ball, but there's going to come a point. This is the third best defense in the country against the run, giving up just over 88 yards per rush. And I think they need to be doing more plays like this.
Cobb dumped it off. It'll be close to a first down on the reception that was made by John McGilvray. McGilvray has been very active. That was Jerome Kemp who put the hit on.
And Cobb very good. Moving in the pocket. He throws very well in the run. He's been doing it. Remember, this is his 7th year in this exact offense. I mean, obviously, they add stuff, take it away through the years. But when he started his freshman year at Stephenville High School, they moved him up to the varsity for the playoffs. So he got almost 5 complete weeks of work backing up Kendall Briles, who was the 4A State Offensive Player of the Year.
This is his 36th consecutive start with another year left to go. So Cobb is going to get a lot of starts under his belt. He is a third-year starter, and you can see controls this offense as well as you could expect, because it is so difficult to run because you have to make so many decisions on the field as you're going. I love this look. Look at this. See the receivers? They don't even bother.
No reason.
They don't come to the huddle. They don't talk to anybody.
It's all memorized. They know exactly what to do.
They just go out and other guys are talking, standing around at the line of scrimmage. The handoff will bring it up to the line of scrimmage, and not much further than that for quarterback Kevin Cobb. Tell us about this offense we're looking at for the team in red.
Every single play has 4 or 5 options. You know, I mean, every play. And you can't write all that down on a piece of paper because it's if this linebacker's two steps out wide here, you're going to hit it here, you know, and if the safety's outside the hash 3 yards, then you're going to do this. And you can't write all that down on paper, you know, and it's just a give and take offense. Whatever the defense gives you, we're going to take it.
It's a great nickname for it, give and take. And that's exactly what Houston has done all season. Cobb's got it. Cobb looking near side on the turn, and that's going to be intercepted at the 40-yard line. 45 down to the 30 and out of bounds. Theo Baines on the interception for Kansas.
Well, this ball was thrown very hard and not very accurately by Kevin Cobb. We talked earlier about Anthony Aldridge has great speed, but not the greatest hands on the team. But this is not his fault. He's just trying to make a play on this ball. And Cobb, when he fires this in there, it's a little behind Aldridge, who tries to get a hand out. It bounces to Baines. Just a bad bounce of the ball for Houston.
So the interception will put Kansas in great field position here. There's the tip. There's the catch. It went right to him. And Theo Baines, the cornerback, with a nice return. It'll be spotted at the 30-yard line. First down and 10. Kansas back on the attack. It'll be carried by Swanson to the line of scrimmage and maybe a yard more, and that will be all. On the quarterback keep, it was Trent Allen, linebacker, and Cade Lane, the right end, moving in on the hit.
And Houston needs something defensively. They do so many different things, and now because of the bad, very little yardage picked up on first down, you might be able to take some chances here. This is a 3-4 defense that shows multiple looks and brings pressure from a lot of different places. I would think some type of zone blitz here, because this is quick change. You're already almost in your own red zone. You've got to take a couple of risks.
13th interception Cobb has thrown. It was the third that Baines has had this year for Kansas. Brings up the second down end to 10. The shovel pass again straight ahead to Cornish. That's what they scored the touchdown on. Gets up to the 20. Still going. Hey, they got another one. Two shovel passes, two TDs to Cornish. 30 yards.
Pursuit by Houston. Bad pursuit. They were late. It's the exact same play they ran on the touchdown before. It's the delayed shovel. So everyone's running off covering, but they've got to recognize this. Marquay Love stays at home and gets a fingertip on Cornish, but no other red jersey showed up. They were late, and he ran through three arm tackles.
Wow. Great effort, and Cornish is having maybe the game of his career. The extra point attempt is up. And it is good. Scott Webb puts it through. So Cornish coming in sharing running back duties with Clark Green, but he's not sharing much in this game. Two touchdowns on the shovel pass. Kansas up.
This telecast is available on ESPN HD, sponsored by Philips Flat TVs with Ambilight. To get ESPN HD, call your cable operator or satellite provider.
So there is John Cornish, the junior from New Westminster, British Columbia, who has scored two touchdowns on passes today, both of them shovel passes, and they are the only two pass touchdown receptions he's had this year.
And the Kansas fans are happy he's not a hockey player, Gary.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate
you throwing that in there. And he's not.
No.
He's very happy to be playing football.
Yeah, Mark Mantino's pretty happy about it right now, too.
Cornish having quite a football game, and both the scores now, the last one we had from Houston, the end of the first half, and the one starting here for Kansas, start of the second half, have come off turnovers as Kansas coughed up a football and a fumble, and Houston scored on it. Now the interception here in the second, and Kansas has scored on it. That is taken out of bounds at the 7-yard line. Well, not quite sure why Anthony Aldridge wanted to catch that. He did.
Well, Cornish has two catches, and both of them are on the exact same play. It's a delayed shovel. That time it was set up very cleanly, but this time this play should have been blown up. Marquay Love does a good job of reading it, but nobody's home. And Allen, the outside linebacker, just completely out of position and then overruns the play. So good speed and a fluid runner, but still the defense for Houston. The first one you could understand. There was good downfield blocking. That thing looked like it was going to blow up in their face and end up being 6 points.
Ooh, that was a high snap, hauled down. It'll be brought up to the 11-yard line. That's going to be a gain of 4 for Ryan Gilbert, trying to get a little running room. Kevin Kane on the tackle, but that snap almost got over the head of the quarterback. Cobb had to reach up and haul that one in.
They've had some problems with their shotgun snaps. Sterling Doty, who played at Stephenville with Kevin Cobb, then went to Army and transferred in. He threw one over his head. The game was over. Earlier in the year, threw one over his head that went for a safety. He's had some problems with the shotgun this year.
Second down and five, adjusting on the call. Cobb looking with three receivers to the near side, goes to the soft side, trying to beat the defender. And no. He got it at the 50-yard line. Donnie Avery, what a catch. It was a one-on-one.
And everybody talks about Vincent Marshall, as they should. But Donnie Avery very quietly has had a great year. And this is what I was talking about earlier. They do so many things underneath, but you just don't throw a ball any better than that. The coverage was fantastic. I mean, Aqib Talib was right there, step for step, but Avery stayed on it. Very quietly, Avery having a very good year.
36-yard gain on that one. Avery with 39 receptions prior to the bowl game and five TDs. A big gain. Keep in mind, they started this drive at the 7-yard line. Now, as you've seen Houston do throughout this game, making a change after they get out there. Four receivers are out. Handoff will be carried to the line of scrimmage, and that's going to be about it by Ryan Gilbert. How about, let's check in with Dr. Jerry Punch on comebacks. Doc.
Hey, guys, you know, when I was up talking to TCU head coach Gary Patterson, he was telling me, he said, when they played the University of Houston on this field a year ago, he said, this team is a very impressive second-half team. He said, Houston had not scored a touchdown the whole ball game. In the fourth quarter, they just caught fire, and they had to hang on to beat them 34-27. He said, this is a very good second-half team, and Art Briles will adjust and put points on the board.
And obviously, they're going to need two here.
And a lot of that has to do with how much you make the defense run in this offense. You make them chase you all the time, and they'll start to tire out.
That one is going to be taken down near the 30-yard line, and all of a sudden, here comes the explosion again. That is Kendall Briles. Cobb on the completion, a 17-yard gain. They're going to go quick here.
Well, Jan Briles, Kendall's mom, and Art's wife didn't want Kendall to play tonight, but we all know, as Doc was saying, that was not going to happen, and that was just a quick slant, and Kendall was a half a step away from breaking that the distance.
Cobb finding some people, 3 for 36 for Briles so far in the game. Again, the multi-splits here, two to the right side, going over the middle, incomplete, and that could have been carried by Marshall a long way.
That's got to be caught.
He had a chance to move on it, couldn't hang on to it. Time for our Aflac trivia question. Here it is. In which one of these bowls has Houston played? Which one of these bowls has Houston played in? Copper, GMC, the Motor City, or the Salad Bowl?
Well, I'll give the hint. How do you pronounce the quarterback from Houston's last name? That's my only hint.
I'll have a Caesar. Cobb back at the 40, looking near side, and off the hands and incomplete. Out of bounds off the near side, Harvey. And Theo Baines was in there on the coverage. Harvey worried about going out of bounds,
yeah,
as well as the coverage.
Yeah, the play before, Marshall needs to make that catch. This one a little more difficult. The defender is there. But Houston's receivers, this is not an easy, I take that back. Harvey needs to make that catch. That's two in a row that they've dropped, and now they put themselves in a 3rd and 10 against one of the best defenses in the Big 12. You've got to make that play.
4 out of 8 for Houston in third down conversions in this game. And they need one right here as they're trailing 21-10. Another eye snap. Cobb again able to make the rebound from the 40. Whips it over the middle. It's caught. But I don't think the receiver got far enough for a first down.
Boy, it's close, Gary.
That is Perry McDaniel.
Boy, is this close spot.
His first reception, and he's going to be shy of the first down by just that much, but they're going to measure it.
Yeah. Remember, the first down marker that we have superimposed is not always 100% accurate. Doty's just got to, you know, he's trying to throw that ball too hard. When I learned how to shotgun snap when I got to the NFL, well, I think he had it from where he was when he caught the ball.
Marcus Hicks put the tackle on. Hicks hasn't been involved very much, getting a tackle right there. Let's see whether he got it. That much short.
You got to go for it. Art Briles has got to go for this. I don't think there's any doubt. He will.
Cobb now 14 out of 27, 173 yards and an interception.
And don't get fancy. Just go back to the quarterback sneak that did or did not score. By the way, I talked to the official, the replay official at halftime. It was exactly what we were talking about. His hunch was that Cobb did not score, but because he could not see the ball, either not cross the goal line or cross, and he couldn't overturn it. So it was the right call.
They had called it a touchdown on the field, and after review, it stayed a touchdown. Now Cobb and Houston will be looking to pick up at least a first down here. Their fourth down conversions during the season, they were 11 for 21. They get a fourth down in inches here. See if they keep the quarterback sneak here. Fourth in Conference USA on those fourth down conversion ratio.
The reason I think you do the quarterback sneak is, remember, 97 tackles for loss for Kansas this year. Sixth in the country. You don't want penetration to ruin a play.
And, boy, that's falling ahead. Unfortunately, that's all they needed. They'll get the first down by the yard, and that's going to give them great field position and a first down and 10 with the ball at the 23-yard line.
Boy, this is a huge conversion. They had two dropped balls in a row that would have taken them inside the red zone. Just goose and go. They didn't even get the snap. That happens actually quite a bit. It's kind of surprising sometimes how many times they're going to measure, but this looked. Didn't it look clearly like you got it?
Yes. And well,
there's our first down. Trust the first down.
That's right. It's a first.
Can someone tell Roy Swanson? Get out of the way.
Cobb now trying to make the comeback here in the second half for this Houston team. Keep in mind that while Houston had a powerful offense, their points per game numbers were a little lower than what you would have expected. They were tied for 40th in the nation at 30 points a game. And with an offense that had 450 yards a game, you'd think there might have been more.
And here's where they got hurt, when they started getting down into the red zone.
They've got a first and 10 to work with here. Cobb back looking. Nobody open on the sideline. Comes back to the weak side. Linebackers move up to put the hit on, and they do, and he gets sacked. Back to the 27-yard line, Rodney Allen.
Well, Cobb's got to know this is coming. When you're playing a defensive front like Kansas, as athletic as they are, when someone stops your progress, just throw it away. You've just got to know that someone's coming. And not only that, Gary, I mean, not just because of the lost yardage, but that's when you get hurt as a quarterback if you don't see it coming. And a big 290-pounder comes and tattoos you.
This Kansas defense trying to rise to the occasion now. Second down at 14 after the loss. Two receivers on each side. Perry in motion. Back for a little screen that's going to be incomplete. And that was really well covered. Ryan Gilbert, the intended receiver, going nowhere. McClinton was over on the coverage. Want to remind you, the Sheridan Hawaii Bowl is coming up Christmas Eve, and that is tomorrow. The Nevada Wolfpack, they will be taking on Central Florida. The Sheridan Hawaii Bowl, part of ESPN's Bowl Road Trip, tomorrow night, 8:30 Eastern Time, Nevada, Central Florida.
I would think something like a flanker screen here. This is a lot of yardage to pick up against this very good defense, and I think you've got to start thinking about 3 points to get it to 8.
Look at the entire team. Yep. The entire team in red looking to the bench because the signs are being given over there by the coaches. And you have to know which one is the active coach because there are about 3 of them over there. Yeah. Going through all kinds of gyrations.
I think I might send in a signal or two. I don't think they'll see us up here, though.
Fort Worth Bowl, Kansas leads at 21-10 over Houston. We'll be right back.
Thank you, guys. What a weekend. Awesome time. Thank you.
Hey, you're marrying a great girl, buddy. Seriously.
Yeah, she is a great girl who would not approve of one single thing we just did.
Isn't that your...
Well, that's going to make an interesting toast.
ESPN College Football, the Fort Worth Bowl, is brought to you by the Nikon D50 Digital SLR. Incredible pictures made incredibly easy. And Philips Norelco, the world's closest rotary shave. That is downtown Fort Worth. Beautiful downtown area with some great old buildings. We welcome you back, third down and 14. Count the receivers. They've got them spread out on both sides of the football. Cobb back looking. Big rush. Gets a bigger rush. All the way back to the 40. Gets away. Heaves it up to the 20-yard line. It is incomplete. It bounced before it could be scraped off the ground. Cobb with the incomplete pass, and it'll bring up a fourth down and long yardage as Donnie Avery could not hold on to that one.
And this will be T.J. Lawrence who comes on. The kickers have not been great this year for Houston, and Lawrence is the guy anything over about 35 yards who trots out to try it.
And before Bell had kicked his 32-yarder that came in the first, Bell kicked that one. Their field goal kickers had missed 3 out of 4 and 7 of the last 11. T.J. Lawrence, you see, that's the long kicks. 44-yarder is being attempted here. The breeze is actually to his back. He gets that one up, got the legs, and it is good. So T.J. Lawrence gets the long field goal. Both he and Bell are walk-on players. Both of them kickers. And so a couple for Houston have come by of the foot. One by Bell, this one by Lawrence. T.J. Lawrence, who is now 5 out of 10 in field goals, will come out to kick it off for Houston as they cut Kansas's lead 21-13, 12 plays, 66 yards. But the Kansas defense not giving up the six-pointer, only the field goal. These teams are meeting for just the third time ever. Kansas has beaten Houston the previous two times they have met. And right now, Kansas has got the lead in this one. These teams played a couple of games back in the 94-95. And now here in the Fort Worth Bowl. Lawrence kicking it off. Kansas has had one punt return by Brian Murphy for a touchdown. He is number 6, and he is out there waiting at the other end. And a line drive kick that'll go through the end line. Let's take a look at our Nikon game track.
Well, the Kansas defense has been what we thought it would be. But we thought it would be Charles Gordon who would get a big play possibly in the kicking game. Instead, it was Brian Murph. And then it's been John Cornish, youngster out of British Columbia. 2 catches, 2 touchdowns on the exact same play. Coaches have had a 72-yard touchdown run against Nebraska when they broke that long streak earlier this year. And coaches really like his speed. That play there, Houston's defense should have been able to make the play, but they just got out of position.
Cobb has taken one in for a 1-yard run. Cornish is back out there in the backfield now as Swanson, a quarterback, puts Kansas back to work on the offense. Look at the hole! Up to the 30-yard line, and probably enough for a first down. But that was one of those Mack truck kind of jobs by the offensive line.
Yeah, you know, it's funny because early in the season, the offensive line for Kansas was not really known for too much. And that's just again, there's just too many red bodies are getting stacked on top of each other. It was just a really nice job by Jake Cox in there spelling Ryan Cantrell at the right guard spot, just taking his man, I believe he was working on Cade Lane, and just taking him right to the outside and just opened up the huge gap.
It looked like they were actually on a wrong read that time with the linebackers as they were following nobody. And Cornish has just been able to pick the holes out here and get it done. That'll bring up the first down and 10. Again, straight ahead out of the backfield. And this time, it'll get up to the 34-yard line. It'll be a 4-yard gain. A little discussion going on down on the field as Cody Pree put the hit on. 8 carries, 52 yards in this ball game for Cornish so far. You see the rushes and 2 receptions and 2 TDs.
You know, we talked about that Nebraska breaking the streak, 36 games. The only one longer in college football is the 42 games that Navy has lost to Notre Dame. But this Kansas program came a long way this year. First time since 1951 they were untied on the field at home. Broke the candy. Nebraska streak, beat Missouri for the 3rd straight time, which has been forever since they've done that.
In the flats, that's going to be caught to the 40-yard line. That's going to be a first down, and they move it up to the 48. Charles Gordon, who continues to have a very strong game despite that injured shoulder he suffered in the final game of the regular season. The Fort Worth Bowl here at the home of TCU. We are in Fort Worth. Riders Stadium is where they play their home games. Varnish for Kansas with two TD receptions. Both have come on shovel passes. Cobb, 182 yards passing. For some quarterbacks, that would be okay. Not for him. He's well below his average and an interception that turned into Kansas points.
Well, the one thing that has been as advertised is this Kansas defense. They are so physical up front. They have given up nothing in the run game to Houston so far.
Watson goes on the first and 10 out of the shotgun. Kansas likes to throw on first down. They try to set the screen up, hit the lineman in the back, and that's a flag will come down on that.
It should be
one.
A penalty. Yeah. Bryles wants a penalty, and he should get one. That's illegal touching on Whitaker.
Flag is out there.
Yeah. I didn't see it come. It's not Big Bob's fault. Quarterback threw it right in his back. Poor guy gets a penalty for just doing his job.
Now, you were a center. Did you ever get hit and or make a catch?
You know, we had a ball. We were playing the University of Oregon one time. Ball flew up in the air, and I went to go catch it, and this linebacker jumped right in front of me, caught it, and went about 50 yards. Didn't score, but that was my only chance ever. Thanks for bringing up a bad memory around the holidays.
Hands.
Yeah. Some of the worst in the business.
Second down and 10, and no gain here. The Houston defense is going to work as Cornish gets hit before he ever got to the line of scrimmage. Scott Lee has had an outstanding year. He and Wade Cole have moved in and out of that middle linebacker position.
Well, it all starts the middle. Remember, this is a 3-4 defense, and the nose guard does a really good job of holding up at the point of attack. And the defensive end over there, Borella, not allowing that. And this is what this defense is based on. Hold the guys up, let the linebackers go and make the play.
Good job by Lee, so it's going to bring up a third down and a 10 for Kansas. They're 3 out of 8 in third down conversions, and they set three receivers near side. Out of the shotgun, Swanson. Big rush is on, and that's where he's going to run. He read the blitz. There's nobody there to the 40, and a flag down as he goes out of bounds at the 32-yard line. A 26-yard gain. Blitz was coming from the quarterback's left side, and when that happened, there was nobody out there to cover. The cornerback was back on receivers, and he took off for the empty spaces.
Yeah, and I think they've got a holding against Kansas, but I also think they're going to get a personal foul over on the Houston sideline.
Late hit.
Yeah, but it looked like it was the continuation of the play. I mean, there's no doubt that Dexton Fields, who got called earlier in this ball game, or excuse me, Brian Murph, who got called earlier. Yeah, the personal foul.
Bryles trying to figure out what it is here because he knew he had one against Kansas. Now he's finding out he's got one against himself.
I think they're going to get Fontenette, the safety, for the late hit out of bounds.
We have Holy, number 88, from the offense, which will be 10 yards from the previous spot. After the play, we have a personal foul against number 8 defense, will be 15 yards from the succeeding spot, automatic first down.
Watching the play, it just looked like a continuation. It's Quinta Williams that they're getting. Here's the hold. We'll show that first because of the effect of the play.
That's Dexton Fields, 88. Yeah.
Fields just doesn't let him go, but from just regular speed, this just looked like a continuation of the play. Well, I don't know how you make that call. I mean, Williams is right there finishing the play.
It brings up a first down and a 10, and that will be maybe for a couple of yards, 3 yards on the carry by Cornish. We've got a 30-30 update with none other than John Buntagrass.
Thanks, Gary Thorne. Big night in the NBA. A couple guys going off for 50 points plus. Allen Iverson scores 53, but the Sixers lose to the Hawks. And Vince Carter got over 50 as the Nets beat the Heat. And just for you, Gary Thorne, the Flyers beat the Penguins. Sidney Crosby, 2 goals. SportsCenter after the game, ESPN News right now.
The hockey talk has got to stop. We're at the Fort Worth Bowl. Come on.
John really knows how to hurt a guy, doesn't he?
You already want a guy from Kansas to go strap on his skates because he's from British Columbia.
He scored 2 touchdowns. Swanson turning right into the defenders and wisely throws that one away. He didn't have Fine open, and he wasn't going to be standing up for very long, so he dumped that one off, and it'll be the incomplete pass. Good pressure put on as the linebackers and ends were charging.
Old number 84. Derek Fine, who his jersey was quote-unquote stolen yesterday out of the locker. I'm just giving him a hard time. He got himself an early, and they got the name on the jersey. That's kind of nice. Usually, when you lose your jersey, usually you get the blank on the back. But fine, who's going to get fined when he gets back to campus? Got his name on there.
Swanson with the third down and the six. The ball at the 32-yard line of Houston. Big splits in that line. Big rushes put on. That's going to be caught at the 20, the 15, the 10. End zone. Here I come. Touchdown. Mark Simmons. 32 yards.
Rocky Schwartz was left one-on-one with Six Simmons, and I think Schwartz is a good player. I just don't know that you want your strong safety covering the fastest guy on Kansas' roster.
Swanson threw only three touchdown passes during the season in the five games he played in. He gets another one here. The kick is up and good by Webb. Swanson now 14 for 23, 224 yards and three TDs, including this one.
Riley, Shaq, Phil, Kobe, plus a finals rematch. Christmas Day doubleheader, noon Eastern on ABC.
I believe in miracles. Where you from? You sexy thing, you. I believe in miracles. Since you came along, you sexy thing.
In love with the rich, bold flavor, Dr. Pepper. One taste and you get it.
Kansas offense scoring-wise, 95th in the nation, averaging 21 points a game.
Not so bad.
Not so bad.
No, and the surprise has been not necessarily that they have the ability to have a good offense because of what Mark Mangino's done in his career, but how well Jason Swanson's played. Quarterback, he's been almost flawless.
Now Houston's going to get the football back. They set the wall up as it is taken at the 12-yard line, turning to the outside Marshall, and Marshall will be brought down at the 19-yard line where Houston will take over.
Well, we haven't seen a lot of all-out blitzes by Houston. We've seen some zones, but this is all-out, so you're going to get one-on-one outside Schwartz on Simmons, and watch when Simmons goes to cut out, Schwartz just falls right down. This is a natural surface that they're playing on. It's in very good shape. This is actually a very, this time of year, TCU should be very proud of this field. It's in great condition, but when Schwartz went to make the break, and that's just not who you want out there covering. You give a little different look to a quarterback like Swanson, who hasn't played a ton, thinking it might mess him up, but he was perfect on that.
Cobb goes across to the 20-yard line, the 25, and near a first down, but it does not look like he got enough on that one. A gain of 6 yards on the play. Avery on the reception. Donnie Avery got it. Houston now's got to move the football here in the third with 4:30 left to go, because Kansas has shown no signs of their offense slowing down.
And the one thing that we haven't seen, we thought we would see, was, you know, getting to the line going. And I think right now that's Houston should take that tempo approach.
That's going to be carried for the first down. We've had a Fort Worth native who plays on the other side of the football, Jermile Ashley, out of there. Dr. Jerry Funch.
And Gary, right now the Jayhawks are going to have to do without the all-conference defensive end. He was helped off in the previous series, and they took him to the side and checked him. Jeff Randall, the orthopedic surgeon, checked his left ankle, and they have retaped him. Craig Bessie, the trainer, retaped him. They're trying to get him to walk around, but he's still very, very ginger, having a hard time to cut. They say he could come back in if needed, but right now he's hanging here on the sideline.
Okay, Doc. Rodney Allen has been in and out in this football game in that defensive end position. Cobb fakes it to the side, wants to go long, man open 30, and incomplete. That is Kendall Briles, who had it on the fingertips but could not bring it in.
Made just a half of a giddy up in his step as he goes to finish this run. As he went to go put his hands up, it's like his stride when you're looking at him at full speed, he missed half a step. If he ran through that ball, I think he makes the catch.
trying to get one of those long bombs in right there. And Bryles, who has been active in this game, reception-wise, that would have been the biggest of all, but not to be. Cobb now 16 out of 32, 191 yards, and an interception. Houston quarterback, that's the third time that Kansas has knocked a pass down at the line of scrimmage. Twice in the first half and once here. Earlier, we asked you our Aflac trivia question. In which one of these bowls has Houston played? Copper, GMAC, Motor City, or the Salad Bowl? The answer at Cunningham.
January 1st, 1952. I knew it all along. Houston 26, Dayton 21. It was a huge game. Phoenix, Arizona.
How many people do you think said Salad Bowl? I would not have. I forgot the Salad Bowl was played. Third down and 10. And Cobb spins around disgustedly. The Kansas defense, Kevin Kane on the charge. Well shy of the first down.
Well, and Kevin Cobb is starting to get a little frustrated. Things just have not gone his way. He's had a couple of balls dropped that should have been caught. He's going up against one of the top defenses in the nation. When Mark Mangino first got to Kansas, they were known for being able to go up and down the field a little bit, but they have turned into one of the better defensive teams in the entire Big 12 Conference.
So Justin Laird is out there. Laird from his own 25-yard line really got the foot into that one. Gordon all the way back at the 7-yard line to the 20, up the middle, 30. Gordon turns it, flag down behind the play. He brings it up to the 37-yard line. Joseph Gonzalez on the coverage made the tackle.
What do you want to bet? It's a block in the back.
Just a guess, huh?
Yeah.
39-yard kick, a 59-yard kick, and a 33-yard return, but all that return will be nullified.
It's so hard for guys
during the return
to pull off.
Block in the back, number 88 in the receiving team. Half the distance to the goal, first down.
Well, that's Dexton Fields, who's going to get called again. And you just, he's a young, true freshman. When a guy gets next to you, you just have to, he's right on his back. When the receiver starts to come towards you, you've got to pull off. Just stop and put your arms up. And they won't call it, but if you keep pushing as they go by, they're going to call you for a block in the back.
Unhappy with it as it costs the field position for Kansas. As their offensive unit will come out now with the first down and 10. Swanson, spectacular night here. You know there have got to be Kansas fans going, gee, what if he'd have been healthy all year?
All year, yeah, and he was the starter coming out of spring ball. And then he hurt his knee 2 weeks before camp and just training, just running.
He goes with a flat pass to the 10-yard line and out of bounds at the 16. Simmons over there, a 6-yard gain, and Simmons standing up now to some of the Houston players and having a word with them. Want to remind you to tune in to the Rose Bowl game. It's on Wednesday, January 4. Pontiac game-changing performance of the year will be voted on now. You can do that at ESPN.com. Just go there and search Pontiac. The winning school is going to receive a $100,000 contribution to their general scholarship fund. There you go. The game-changing moment. Handoff will be at the line of scrimmage and no further on the carry. Swanson trying to put a little run down there to keep the linebackers honest, but Clyde Green did not have anywhere to go. Green, who averages 58 yards a game on the ground. There you see the numbers.
This is the surprising part. Not surprised that Kansas' defense has played so well, but it's astonishing how much more efficient they've been in the passing game. That's where they struggled all year. They changed guys out. Adam Barman started. Brian Luke. Swanson, who was hurt, finally got the job against Missouri.
They were 93rd in passing in the nation in Division I. That one is going to be tipped at the 25-yard line and incomplete. Over there was Courtney Sterling, cornerback on the coverage by Swanson.
And Houston needs something momentum changing, and nothing spells momentum like a blocked punt.
He thought if he caught this, he's got a touchdown. But he really didn't have a chance.
No. That was a little miscommunication. But Houston can block punts. They've got Three already this year. I would come after this one.
This is the first punt Kansas has had in the football game. Kyle Tucker, 16th in the nation, averaging 43 yards a kick, and a timeout is going to be taken by Kansas.
And it was Nick Reed, the Big 12 Conference Defensive Player of the Year, who's playing the up-back personal protector, who didn't like what he saw. They were outnumbered. And he just didn't like it. Houston was coming after that, and he just absolutely did not like it.
He is one heck of a player, and just how good is he, and how much do you know about him, and you don't even know you know it?
Bob Parr.
Honest, Mr. Reed out there right now.
Looks just like Bob Parr, a.k.a. Mr. Incredible. To me, it's uncanny. Do you see it?
I agree. Now, the question is, if you look at Nick Reed or Mr. Incredible, make a decision on who you like with the looks. What do you think, Nick?
I think I'm a little better looking than he is, but there's a few similarities there.
No, I'm going to go with Mr. Incredible.
Ooh, harsh.
Yeah, sorry.
Harsh.
I'm a big fan. Well, here's the thing. This guy bench presses 3 million pounds, and he benches about 425. So we'll go with Mr. Incredible for the winner.
Not even a race. Not even a race. Nick Reed, the Big 12 Defensive Player of the Year. And I said, how could you have grown up in the Midland of America with the curls of a surfer from Manhattan Beach?
Yeah.
I mean, he looked like someone right out of California when you see him, doesn't he?
Yeah, he was giving us the hang loose sign. I knew we were in trouble when he walked in.
Yeah.
And he describes himself as laid back. Although, not so sure about that.
No. He's been their leading tackler. He's been their leading solo tackler. He's up there among the leaders in tackles for a loss. And it is the first time in 115 years Kansas has had a conference defensive player of the year. Here comes the punt. It is up by Laird to the 36, and look out. There's going to be a flag because that may have been right on the face mask. That was Mark Simmons, who's been involved in discussions already with Houston.
You know, they changed this rule. For a while there, they had the halo rule where you had to give them 6 feet of room to catch the ball, and now it's just the opportunity to catch it. And I'm not so sure that Mark Simmons did not give the guy the opportunity to catch this ball.
Well, he did catch it.
Yeah, so by... don't let the facts get in the way of the penalty.
Against the kicking team.
The opportunity cannot interfere with the opportunity to catch it. If the guy caught it, can't be a penalty, can it? That's a great point. Let's just make the audience aware that you are a lawyer by training.
Now you've killed me.
Well, I tell you, if anything, they could have got him on a personal foul for going to Marshall's head. They definitely could have got him for a personal foul for wrapping up around the head. So one of those penalties should be called, Counselor.
What do you think, Doc?
I was told by the side judge here that it was simultaneous contact with the catch and the contact with the tackler. You've got to give him a chance to bring the ball down and become a runner. That was the call. That's what cost him the yard.
I'd like to cross-examine, Doc.
Yes. Ipsy Dixie, we used to say in law school. That's going to be carried by Cobb and out of bounds at the 40-yard line. The proof... My spotter, Dave Dare, here is also a lawyer. We got you surrounded up here.
No kidding. I'm going to back away.
Only another lawyer would know about Ipsy Dixie. The fact proves the point. Anyway, it's Houston's football. Well, more or less. No, that's a... No.
Should I just leave it alone?
Just leave it alone. Don't get into it.
Let a dog sleep.
Let a dog sleep right there. Cobb's got it at the 40-yard line. Houston on the attack now, 28-13 here. Plenty of time to go in the football game with another quarter plus a minute 41 here. It's their ability to convert here after some of their drives have been stalled, ending up in a couple of field goals and a couple of times with nothing. Now the lob toss, dangerous one. The defense had to be provided by the receiver because Theo Baines almost had that, and Harvey had to knock it away.
And it's the pressure by Kansas that changes this. Harvey comes to the inside, and Cobb has to throw this falling away from the pressure. A pretty good throw considering there was pressure, but he straightened up on his route trying to adjust to the ball. But even the 6'5" Harvey could not go up and make a play because of the pressure.
Third down and 7 now. This is what's happened to Houston all night long.
Yeah, they've been behind the sticks.
They are 4 out of 11 in third down conversions. And that's a bad incomplete intended for Harvey again. Flags go down. There are a lot of discussions going on. This is getting a little testy, not just football-wise, but verbally on the field. And we may see a few more
Houston,
of these.
And Houston was involved in an ugly incident after the Sheraton Hawaii Bowl last year against Hawaii. There was a big brawl in the middle of the field after that three overtime game that Hawaii ended up winning. So both of these coaches need to get their guys calmed down.
And obviously you can see from Bryles on the sideline, this is going to go against Houston.
Number 74 of the offense, the penalty is refused, fourth down.
Well, this is something that Bill Young, the defensive coordinator, told me about this morning. He said, you know, when we looked at the film, we would count how many missed calls there were for ineligible men downfield, a tight end who was covered up by a receiver running downfield, catching a pass, and they didn't call illegal formation. And it's very difficult. This ACC crew has its handful with Houston. That ball thrown in front of the line of scrimmage, so the lineman can't go downfield. Good call.
Laird gets the kickoff, and Gordon's going to let that one go on the near side. Bounces at the 15. It'll take a bounce back to about the 13-yard line. And Kansas will take the football over again as their defense again gets the job done. Sunday night, Brad Johnson, Minnesota Vikings, trying to continue their late season surge as they go against Ed Reed and the Baltimore Ravens. Coverage begins with NFL Primetime presented by Miller Lite at 7:30 Eastern Time. Vikings and Ravens, Sunday night football.
Well, Kansas has been the second bad field position start they've had. The one before was because of the penalty. This one because of a pretty decent punt by Laird. They need to get some of this field position back.
Swanson on the handoff. They've been able to do it with some pretty good rushing by Cornish in these situations. And again, he is there on the carry. Gets it up to about the 15-yard line. And Free again moved in on the hit.
But I think the guys in red now are sitting on run. They're squatting in. They're bringing extra bodies into the line of scrimmage. I think a little play-action pass with Gordon slipping by Schwartz again might be in order.
Their average starting position was on the 32-yard line during the regular season for Kansas. They've had a couple of those in this game, one on the turnover and the interception, great field position against Houston that they turned into a touchdown. A second down and 8 here. Swanson looking on the cut in at the 25. Coming over to the 30, still on his feet at the 35, 36. Brian Murph flags down. Here's the discussion going on.
They're going to add 15 to this one for a face mask.
21-yard gain for Murph.
And there's a field position change. One play. I believe they're going to give Rodney Rideau, the linebacker.
Face mask. Number 8 of the defense. 15 yards from the end of the run.
Well, that's one thing we said at the top that has come true, and that's that penalties this season have hurt Houston, and they've hurt them in this game.
Well, when you're reaching out, it is Rideau, not Williams, who turns his head all the way around. Yeah, that's why it was the 15-yard variety, not the 5-yard.
So that'll be an automatic first down. There you see the penalties for Houston, 4 for 54 yards. Kansas, 8 for 69.
But it just seems like those four have been completely untimely. You know?
Yeah.
Just,
they've resulted in first downs, kept the ball alive for Kansas. And they are at midfield. Swanson out of the shotgun. They've run this a number of times. That little flat screen is going to be good for about 5 yards. And more extra hitting takes place. The officials better get this one under control. Courtney Sterling on the hit. Every play now is being finished with some chit-chat down on the field.
Well, Brian Murph throws the bone. The forearm shivering to the chest of Sterling. And it's hard to knock a guy when he does something like this for not gabbing a little bit.
And Rideau came over.
And I got to tell you, if that were done on Kansas' sideline, it would have erupted.
Both teams are coming to the sideline now. We're going to get a timeout because the quarter's over. And that probably came just in time to avoid any more nastiness. Well, can Kansas get it done? So far in this game, they've taken advantage of turnovers. They've used the shovel pass, and they've got the lead.